The Whiskey Throttle Show, now available on the Spot Network, an independent standalone streaming platform, live now on Apple TV, Roku, Amazon Fire, Google Play, Android TV, most smart TVs, and all phones and tablets. Look for future live shows and specials only available on Spot Network. Download the app today on your favorite device. Coming to you from the Troy Lee Design Saloon in Corona, California, it's the Whiskey Throttle Show, brought to you by Yamaha, the leaders in the power sports industry. Motocross bikes, street bikes, adventure bikes, generators, side-by-sides, quads, boats, Yamaha sets the standard. Yamaha revs your heart. Today's guest is presented by PowerDot, the world's smartest muscle recovery and performance tool. PowerDot takes proven electronic muscle stimulation technology and packs it into a sleek, lightweight, easy-to-use pod that is completely controlled from your smart device. Today's show brought to you in part by Method Race Wheels, the strongest, lightest, fastest wheels in off-road. Method dominates the off-road racing market, and they have wheels for your truck, Sprinter, SUV, Jeep, or van. Troy Lee Designs, built for the world's fastest racers. Troy Lee Designs blends elite-level protection with a history of industry-leading style and performance. From motocross gear to custom paint to bicycle protection, Troy Lee Designs is waiting for you on the next level. This week on the Whiskey Throttle Show, Nathan Ramsey is a former 125 Supercross champion, a 450 Supercross winner, and he sits second on the all-time 125 Supercross win list behind James Stewart. And now, here's the host of the Whiskey Throttle Show, David Hingry.
February 13th, 2021. Thanks for joining us here at the Troy Lee Design Saloon. It's the Whiskey Throttle Show. I'm your host, David Pingree, and today we've got 1999 125 Supercross champion, 450 Supercross winner, a guy sitting way up on the all-time 125 Supercross win list. Nathan Ramsey was with us. Nate, welcome.
Hey, thanks. Glad to be here.
Stoked to have you, dude. We had you, tried to get you in a while ago, and COVID kind of swatted us down, but
yeah, I didn't really want to wear the mask in here with
So we're
covers up my mustache.
It does.
It covers my mustache. That thing is fantastic, by the way. I love it. And riding shotgun with me today, I got Nate's good buddy, my good friend, five-time arena cross champ, buddy Antunez, sitting in. Thanks for coming, dude.
Yeah, appreciate glad to ride shotgun. I know a little bit about Nathan's backstory, probably from the early days, too. Maybe something somebody hasn't heard before.
Yeah, well, I know you guys have been buddies for a long time, so a lot of those little stories, it'll be fun to have you kind of chime in. And we want to get you in that seat soon.
Yeah.
We talked about maybe getting Joel Albrecht and one of those boys from the old
Richie
Canyon.
That would be awesome. Yeah, Richie Canyon boy would be a lot of fun.
Anyway, excited. We got a lot to get to today, so I don't want to waste a ton of time. Let's jump right into our Method Race Wheels front-end chatter. These guys bringing you the fastest, lightest, strongest wheels in off-road. If you guys are looking for something for your truck, Sprinter van, SUV, UTV, you want your wheelbarrow to look sicker. I mean, go to Method. You get 20% off using our code WHISKEYTHROTTLE. No spaces, no caps. Those guys make some rad stuff, so check them out. Guys, the first thing I want to get into, and Nathan, you're working as the what's your title? Amateur director?
No, manager of amateur racing.
At KTM?
Yeah.
Okay, which gives you all the KTM brands.
Yep.
Or how are they saying that? The KTM group?
Group,
brands.
Yeah.
Okay. They got rid of arena cross, and, you know, we see now, like, guys are jumping in sort of at different times from amateur to pro. Some guys start at the nationals, which I've always thought is a really good step. You know, get some pro racing on a track that you're familiar with. You know, it's not such a step to Supercross, and then after at least a handful of races that season, then try Supercross the next year. But without arena cross and without there being any kind of rules, what do you guys think is the best way to get a kid from that amateur level into pro racing, the safest and to have the most success?
Well, honestly, this is a pretty hot topic right now, you know, trying to figure out what's a good direction to take. And I think it is, you know, sometimes it's individualized, you know, to the rider and what he's capable of and the momentum that he has going. I do agree that, you know, starting in outdoors, which is something they've raced their whole life, is a little cleaner, seems a little easier. It's a, you know, it's a bigger track. There's more room to, I guess, make mistakes or do it right. So I would say that route would be the number one choice. But sometimes it just can't happen depending on timing, injuries, you know, other things that can play into it. So, you know, for me, I think that they, you know, before COVID hit, they were onto something with the, you know, road to Supercross or the future Supercross.
Yeah.
That was getting better each year, and it was getting a little more serious. I'm kind of behind the scenes, always pushing as far as the actual futures class, going, hey, I like where we're at, but we got to move these guys to Saturday with the pros. Like, if they really are, the next step is for them to be there racing as a pro. Let's push them to that pedestal. Let's let them get a following. Let's get some people behind them that maybe don't know them. You know, there's a lot of good things I believe would come out of that, which obviously they listen, but it's easier said than done. There's a time constraint. You know, you got to work a lot of little details out. I think it's doable, and I think we were getting pretty close to considering that, but, you know, this last year and this year is just kind of just trying to get it done.
Now so when you say that, do you mean during the day, like during timed qualifying, or are you talking about include them into the show?
I would want them in the show. You know, we have KTM Junior Racing on at 10 of the events, you know, and even if you didn't do all of the events, you know, we had talked about doing, you know, maybe 4 or 6 of them just for this futures class. I think that, you know, you could kind of pick the ones that the KTM Juniors aren't at, so they have a little bit more time, and, you know, get their qualifying done. And maybe you do it a little bit earlier. Like, you could maybe, you know, as the fans are coming in and starting to sit down. But you really, I mean, to get the best out of it, I think you want the fans to be able to see it. You know, there's a platform there for all of us manufacturers who we would love to see that. You know, the individual rider's building his own brand as that goes. He gets a fan base before he's actually even pro. Yeah. So it's kind of better for, in my mind, it's better for everybody. But I do agree and understand that there's details that need to be worked out for time, you know, just timing of the event, TV time, all that stuff. But I believe it can be worked in. It'd just be the structure of the, you know, the event or the night show in itself.
Don't you feel like, though, Nate, with the group of riders and the talented that's coming up through the amateur ranks, these kids are starting to ride supercross earlier and earlier now. So getting them that experience inside a stadium is a lot different than having them ride a track out at their house, if they have one by their house, or one of the facilities that you use in California. Taking what they're learning there and finally being able to tailor that a little bit to the stadium and the tough box and all those things that kind of tighten up that experience, it would allow these racers to gain a little more and then ultimately, I think, better when they ultimately go into the big pro class, you know?
Yeah, for sure. All that stuff, those are all great points. And I believe that, you know, if these guys can get exposure to it when it matters a little less, I mean, I know we all That's know good. In the amateur world, everything matters, even the lap time on Tuesday at Paula or Fox Raceway. But, you know, like in the end, like if they can get in there, get used to seeing the lights and the crowd and kind of the ups and downs. And like you said, I mean,
sticky
no
dirt.
One thinks about it. Like the tough blocks, just adding a tough blocks to a supercross track, you're all of a sudden, you're a little claustrophobic, you know?
Yeah.
So I do agree. I think that would be huge. And, you know, there's tough blocks on Sunday when they do the actual complete amateur day, but they're trying to cram so many classes and so much racing into one day, it gets kind of watered down and spread out. Then you got to make the track where, you know, the vet guy can do it as well as, you know, the guy who's really, you know, it could have been Max Volin, you know, he could have been doing that, you know, in a normal situation. So there's such a gap there. There's a lot of different discussions on how to do it, but ultimately I would love to see kind of how they do it at Monster Energy Cup when they, you know, they have a, you know, futures class or whatever you want to call it, you know. I believe that that's the correct way to do it. It's just a matter of laying out the, you know, the time frame and the platform to do it on.
It sure is different now than it was when we were all on 80s, right? I never got on a supercross track on an 80, I don't think. I mean, maybe you sneak on one here or there. I think I rode out at De Anza on that old track or something.
Yeah.
Like Hayden Deegan has his own soupy track. He's out there riding all the time on an 80, you know. And even watching it, I'm like, man, it looks crazy, like seeing an 80 ripping triples and going through whoops. But I think a lot of those top guys are all in that same boat now.
Oh, 100%, yeah.
They're not 80s anymore, by the way. They're 85s.
Oh, sorry. That's how old I am.
I made that mistake
My mom
for a
asked
long
me
time.
That question the other day because I was talking about 85. She goes, aren't they 80s? And I'm like, no, Mom, they're 85s now.
Did the CC really change, or we just
yes.
called it?
Yeah.
It went up?
Yeah. 84.9 CCs.
Where did I go? Where have I been?
My mom's 69, too, so, Ping, you need to, you know, step up your game.
No, so, but seriously, like,
Mom, my Antunez got my number.
it's amazing to me, you know. And then you take an 85 and you turn it into a super mini, and the power to weight ratio on a super mini is crazy. And the things that these guys can do, because we've done a lot of preparation back in the day for the Monster Cup for the super mini class, and then, you know, I'm out with Hayden here and there, and I mean, he's actually at a supercross track today. It wasn't even his own, because he's like, all right, well, I got things down on my own. Now I need to start switching around and getting used to being able to switch tracks, which is smart, you know? And, you know, when you approach, like, say, a 3-footer out of the corner on a super mini, you got a little more track to work with because the wheelbase is shorter, but you got a good power to weight ratio. They can do almost anything a big bike can do. It's pretty cool. Yeah. I mean, blitz the whoops, right?
Blitz the whoops, yep.
Really, on those little bikes, you get across the whoops.
Oh, yeah.
It's pretty cool. So, yes, that level, and you know, he's on the elite side of it or the higher end of everything, but man, kids everywhere are getting exposed to supercross tracks. So the fact of, you know, some of the reservations from, you know, supercross is like, oh, would they really be ready? Do we need to make a lane for them to go around the whoops? And I'm like, no, they can do it. They can handle it, you know?
Yeah. And they'll figure it out. If
right. Well, what's worse? You know, if you were, you know, a factory rider and you're getting a paycheck and all of a sudden you're trying to figure it out at that point, or the year before when, you know.
I think that's the big struggle, and I think you in your position, like, you know, feeding guys to Roger DeCosta and the Gas team like that, like, they're relying on you to help guide these kids and position them right. So being able to have to know that, hey, he's been through every step, he's more than ready, I think that could help.
Yeah, and you know, we all know, because we're racers, it's more than just being able to get on a track and execute it. Like, a lot of people can get on a track, look good, and then you throw, you know,
all the other stuff,
you know, the other 21 the crowd, guys the routers, out, the crowd, yeah. the tough blocks, like, all that stuff plays in. So, you know, it's a process. So I think it's great that these kids are starting off early. And for instance, one of my riders, Dax Bennick, lives in North Carolina. Mm-hmm. You know, he has land. His dad has tons of equipment because he owns a business where he uses all that stuff all the time. And he's grown up from a scaled down supercross track, and every year that he progressed, it's progressed with him.
Yep.
So this kid now is like stepping on the real supercross tracks, and he's like, it ain't that hard.
No big deal.
Yeah, not that hard.
It's crazy. I spent some time working with Daxon too, just to take a little from him. And the kid went out, we were riding outdoors when I was there working with him, and then he went over to supercross track for a day just to play. The kid logged like 10 laps, and usually, you know, when you go from outdoor supercross, your heart rate goes through the moon.
Mm-hmm.
He was barely out of breath, and he, you know, so his skill level and his natural kind of ability to ride a supercross had been kind of formed from young. So it's just kind of more of a natural thing to him than getting on there and being tense and tight.
Well, that's why I wanted to ask you guys this question, because you're working with a lot of top amateur kids. You're, you know, managing KTM's amateur program. I don't even realize they've gone from 80 to 85 cc. I'm way out of that loop. So that's interesting stuff. Do you think, I mean, arena crosses back, will they ever go back to something like that where you got to do some arena crosses? Or do you?
I hate
that?
Arena cross. No, I'm just kidding.
Arena cross is so lame.
Sorry, Ben. Yeah, I'm just kidding.
That's probably because I beat you every time you came over.
You did. He beat up on me. He loved to invite me and then knock me off the track and be like, wait, what are you doing here?
him and Mike Jones.
I think that was definitely an avenue for sure. You know, it's obviously even tighter, so... You know, the thing about that is, like, you know, the arena cross whoops, a lot of times are worse than they are at supercrosses.
There's no run.
And it's a tighter, confined area, and you got kids with less experience. It's almost
more dangerous.
It's almost tougher.
Yeah.
And it's easier to hit somebody. Like, it's tough. So either way you go, it's always a risk, right? You know, so I just think exposing them early on and, you know, moving up the ladder. And if you look at across the board, all sports are like this, right? Kids are starting to learn, you know, they'll lock into one sport early in life and go, all right, I'm a football player. You know, and they're off season, they got quarterback coach or shot coach, whatever it is, you know, along the way. And so everything is elevated because people go, they zone in on one thing.
Do you think that's good? I don't know that I love these kids getting that focused that early. I feel like you're going to see more injuries, specific injuries to each sport. Like, you got a kid pitching from the time he's 7.
Yeah. What you could see too is them getting burned out as well. You know, I think I think a diversified athlete's always a better athlete, and to spend a little bit, especially when they're young, in our sport in particular, to take that time off and just go do other kid stuff and play another sport is huge, because, you know, their amateur career is already this big anymore with how young you're signing the kids up, right, Nate? And then, you know, you want your professional career to be that big. So if you got two things like this and you've been burning candle from both ends at all times, you're going to get there and there's going to be something that could flame out.
Yeah.
You know? So
That's definitely a big worry. You know, you put all your eggs in one basket and you get there and you're just like, oh, man, I like basketball better than baseball, you know? So I was a believer. I'm the same as you. I was like, all right, I'm going to expose my kids to everything, right? And then at some point I'm going to see them like go towards one sport, you know, and that happened with my son. He loved basketball, so he went for it, and he's 5'10", 5'11", you know, he's my son. And, you know.
But you were a good basketball player.
Well, it's athleticism, but when, you know, you're a little bit of an uphill battle when most of the kids that are getting pulled into colleges are, you know, the point guard is 6'3", and he weighs 200 pounds or something, you know what I mean, compared. You can get it done for sure, and I always encourage him. But, you know, he was drawn to that. So it's like, even if I thought, oh, you got a better chance at baseball, soccer, whatever, football even. Like, whatever it was, I couldn't create that passion for him, right? So I wanted him to see everything and lock into what he enjoyed the most and what he could push himself. Because when you're actually trying to get to the next level, like, it doesn't matter how good you are at it. I mean, yes, it does matter. But if you don't have that locked-in passion and that desire, there's going to be a turning point. Yeah. Where you choose to go a different direction. When, you know, you can go two ways when the work gets hard. You can rise up and work with it, or you can run from it. And we see it all the time.
That's a great point because, it's not always fun. Mm-mm. And when that workload starts, if you don't really love it, you'll never do it. You'll never follow through with it.
Yep.
You're going to flame out.
All right, next. That's good stuff. I appreciate the thoughts there. I want to ask this because it's been –
tell the tape.
I wasn't gonna say that, but it's been an issue this year. Lappers, blue flag, between Freezy and the Wilson incident, it's been rough. And so I know that it's tough. I've been that guy in a race for someone with 10th. And the lappers or the leaders come around, and it's like, well, I'm trying to race this guy, or there's another guy right behind me. I don't want him to pass me. But in these situations that we've had this year, there's been no one around these guys. You can see they know the blue flag's being waved at them, and they've affected the outcome of these races significantly. What's the solution? What do you guys think? What's your thoughts?
I'll go first. You know, I've been on both ends of it. You know, I've been leading and trying to go around someone on a white flag lap, same kind of scenario, and got hit by him and taken out and ended up second, I think, on the night, same thing. And afterwards, I was like, you know, I was mad, obviously, that I lost the race, but I also am putting some on my own self that, you know, did I really need to, you know, force the pass right then to get by him? Did I not read it right? Was there something better that I could do? So, I mean, some accountability has got to come back to what your part in it was. On the other end, you know, when you're not up front in the battle for a lead, you know, and you're getting lapped and you're in 10th or like something like you said, if you're not in a battle with somebody else, then you need to try to find a space to let them get by. If you are, I mean, you can't really, you're trying to gain positions, not lose positions. So sometimes, you know, staying in the battle and letting the faster rider try to, you know, hold your line and get around you, that's, you know, always something that you can do. But it's tough decisions from both ends is where I'm going with it.
Yeah.
And you can't say what's right or wrong. You know, I guess some people can say what's wrong. But being in that scenario when you're that person in there, you're not trying to mess the person up behind you. You're trying to do the right thing, and sometimes you miscalculate something as well.
And I don't mean to say that either of those riders did anything intentionally. I think it was completely unintentional, but it did have a massive effect on the outcome. My theory was always, because I got lapped at the Nationals on a good occasion, whether it was a bad start or a crash, whatever, and I would always like, oh, okay, good, here comes Ricky. And I would try to jump in with him.
Yeah, I've done that before,
you know,
too. Yeah.
I think then when he starts lapping people, they'll think, oh, man, Ping's doing good. Look at him right on Ricky. And then I could pick guys off. I would go forward you know, more. Now, that wasn't a last lap situation, but, anyway, what do you think?
Yeah, I think it's, again, like you guys have said, it's situations. You know, we don't know everything's going on the track and what's, you know, under the helmet, you know. Obviously, a lot of times it's later in the races. You're tired. You're not, you know, you may not be thinking straight, as well as the leader's not thinking straight. So there's a lot of little things that play into it. But I do believe that, you know, well, for me, whenever I got lapped, I not only didn't want to get in their way, I was trying to get out of the camera's view too, just so. Hey, number 25, watch out.
Well, now you got 100 cameras on you at all times.
Yeah, true. You can't get away from it. But you know, I think it's definitely something that's very important. It's like, okay, on one hand, it could be whoever's getting lapped because they're lapping up to what, seventh place sometimes, or further in the lights. I think they did. It's like it could be your best finish of your career. And, you're supposed to chill out. And like you said, there wasn't anybody, it wasn't as tight of, but a lot of times it is tight and you are racing and you've poured everything into this moto, just like the leader. But still, there's got to be a level of respect for the blue flags. I think, you know, I all the way around, like, you know, I'm sure AMA and the track crew could do a little bit better job. Sometimes I know, just thinking back into the day when I was, you know, they start throwing the blue flag so early.
Yeah.
There are three lanes behind you, and you're just like, you're watching over your shoulder, and then you're like, well, I don't, blue flag don't mean anything to me anymore. So
that's a good point.
There's a little bit of the things that could be better, and I think they understand that too, and they know that, and they don't have enough people probably with blue flags or whatever, but the simple fact that it can be thrown so early, you know, that maybe there needs to be a different color that goes, here's an aware, they're coming soon, and then, you know, different color blue, like light blue, oh, this one's dark blue, they're about to get you, whatever.
And that is a really good point, because you do start to go, well, man, I've been seeing this blue flag, and there's no one, I'm just, forget it.
So you get back into your mode, you know? Yeah.
But maybe, I've heard this, maybe this is the way it's supposed to be, but I don't know that it always happens this way. If they're showing it to you, it means heads up, they're coming.
Right.
And when it is waving at you, it's like, get the F out of the way. Yep. They're on you. Like,
that's true, but I think where Nathan's going with it is they start giving you that when they're two lanes away, and it's not really relevant at that point. So you, as a rider, you look over a lane because you can look over lanes in Supercross, and you go, well, he's still two lanes over there. I need to stay focused on what I'm doing. And it goes back to what you're saying, Nathan, is you're out there giving as much as the leader, for sure, 100%, sometimes more.
Right.
You know, because, you know, you're back in 10th or 11th trying to catch people in front of you, and the leaders sometimes get a gap, and they're flowing, and you might not be flowing. So, you know, there's a lot going on. So that is a very good point. You know, maybe it's coming a little early, and you know, maybe there's something they could change there to help that.
And like you said, if you're battling with a guy, because there are battles going on hard for 10th, 12th, you know.
Oh, yeah.
And like you said, it could be the guy's best finish ever. That's one thing, and I give those guys way more latitude because they're still racing. This is still their living. Right, they're trying to build a career, but when you're all by yourself and they're coming through, like, I just think there's no excuse for that, man. Like, you need to get out of the way.
Yeah, well, the tables, they turn, right? So if you've been on both ends, you understand a little bit more. You know, if you've only been on the end of needing people to get out of your way because they're getting the blue flag, then you got a different opinion.
Yeah.
But if you've ever been in that race part of it where you're getting a blue flag but you're still in a battle and you're trying to get out of their way but also, you know, your position, you're going to have kind of a different mindset of what that blue flag means at times, you know?
Yeah. And let's keep in mind, on a Supercross track, it's a little harder to get out of the way. You know, I know, you know, I have two of my Orange Brigade riders that are racing Supercross for the first time, and Josh Fariz, he was getting lapped in one of them, and he didn't, like, in my mind, you need to plan it out a little bit. You know, if you know they're coming, you know they're getting closer and closer. You know, if you decide, okay, I'm going to get out of the way right here, and you blow a whole rhythm section,
right?
Then you just cost yourself a lot of time. So I encouraged him. I said, look, if you know they're coming, you're about to get lapped, time it to where you follow them into this big rhythm section instead of, like, waiting, and then you're rolling. You just lost, you know, 5 seconds on the guy that you've been chasing down for five laps, you know? So plan it out a little bit better. So there's a little bit, I think, of education to go with it, and because he had no idea, he just knew he didn't want to get in the way, right?
Yeah.
You know, and which I respect that too. But at the same time, he was sitting in a position that was his best finish ever.
Yeah.
So
you don't want to give up seven.
It happens. Yeah. But ultimately, in the pecking order, you know, for sure, if you're racing for first place or top three or whatever. That's going to take precedent over somebody who's, you know, pouring themselves into, you know, seventh or tenth place. You know, I mean, it just is. There's a lot more on the line for the companies, the sponsors, the rider, you know, everybody that's involved in this whole thing. And, you know, you just don't want to be the topic of this discussion right here.
Oh. And poor Dino got roasted.
Yeah, and he did. And we all know he's a great, great guy. Yeah. But for whatever reason, in that moment, I don't know what he was thinking, but it was a bad choice.
Yeah.
If it was a choice, right? Wow. And then, you know, you go, you flash over to Vince Freeze and you go, okay, you know, his name's been in this conversation more often, right? When you start to be one of those guys that's in the conversation more often, you got to start to kind of check yourself. I mean, I would, this is me talking. I would go, okay, what am I doing? I'm making some bad decisions at these times. And you know, for sure he didn't want to cause that to happen or do anything like that. But there was other opportunities where if you rewind this back up that race where Barsha landed on him and TK, me and TK have talked about this a lot. And it's like, if you back that up and you go, there was an opportunity for him to notice and go, all right, I'll do this little main line, do it the generic way.
Yeah. Swing wide
and be okay. And then exactly what you said, my trick was jump in, stay as long as you can. And
watch their
lines. People will go like, pew, pew. And you're just like picking up positions because they think you're part of the race.
Yeah. I'm in the hunt, race of my life. Yeah.
Podium to the left.
Yeah, you can use that for your advantage. So, you know, I hate it for everybody involved all the way around. You know, I mean, there's the other side of a guy crashes in front of the leader, which happened the weekend before with
Mosman.
Yeah. Basically, you know, you got all kinds of things to look at and try to avoid, and it's motorcycle racing's tough.
Yeah,
but you definitely don't want, you know, a knucklehead just blocking you. You know.
Yeah, crash. I mean, what do you do? Yeah, I tried to crash. I mean, you didn't want to crash either. Yeah. So, well, interesting stuff. Appreciate your takes on that, guys. I want to remind you, get over to the whiskeythrottleshow.com. We got all our shows up there. You can listen to anything we've done in the past 3 years. All of our merchandise is on there. We got links to all our sponsors, so check that out. Temecula T-shirt printers, putting all that stuff together. So we're really appreciative of all that. And let's get to our partner here, our show, the main show. It's the main event. Brought to you by PowerDot, our guy Nate Dog.
Give us one bark at least. Come on.
Barf. Yeah. I've heard better.
Yeah.
If I bark in this thing, everybody will.
So tell me about growing up in Tennessee. Hickson?
Mm-hmm.
What's Hickson like?
It's H-I-X-S-O-N, not H-I-C-K-A.
Oh, I just got H-I-X-O-N. No.
Yeah.
But I don't even know how many CCs are in them anybody. Yeah, so yeah.
No, I just mean most people when I say they're like, oh, Tennessee Hick. You know, you're a Hickson. But, yeah, I grew up Hickson, Tennessee, just a little country boy. I grew up trail riding, really. You know, my first bike I had was a Z50, and
did your dad ride or something? Or like, how did you get introduced?
We just had like 9 acres of land, and you know, I have no idea. I haven't actually asked my parents like what brought that on. You know, like buying a couple motorcycles, but it's pretty common. You know, if you got some land, you want to cruise around your land on your motorcycle. So, you got a Z50. Me and my brother. Yeah. My brother's 3 years older than me, and mine had an N on the number plate, and his had a B for Brent. And one quick funny thing is when I first got it, I was like 3, and my mom said I'd be out in the yard and I'd want to ride. So I'd get everything set up, put on the kickstand, get on top of it, start it, get off, cause I couldn't put the kickstand up and stay on it. Right. Put the kickstand up, throw my leg over and it would die. She said I would just do that
over
like,
and over.
It'd take me like 4 or 5 times to get going.
She's like, I don't got to worry about him going nowhere.
Yeah, she wasn't too worried.
He's not leaving the garage.
Yeah, so grew up just trail riding, doing that stuff, you know, spent a lot of time riding in the woods and climbing hills, and there's a lot of cool stuff in Tennessee like that. Yeah. And then when I was 12, I ended up going to my first race. First off, I ended up getting a two-stroke that had a power band that I was like, oh, my gosh, this thing is crazy. How do these people ride it? But I loved the suspension.
At 12, that was your
first? Yeah, I was probably 11.
Okay.
When I got my, somewhere right there. Yeah. Okay. But I did. I raced not too long after that, just locally, and I loved it. But my fourth race in, I broke my leg and then kind of got into skateboarding and just mainstream sports and did a bunch of other stuff until I was like 15.
Well, what about from 3 to 12? Were you doing other sports? Like, what were you doing? Just normal kid stuff?
Yeah, I love sports. You know, we grew up at the baseball fields, football, you know, whatever season it was, we were playing that sport, and my parents were super involved. My dad was a coach. My mom would be the announcer, whatever, you know, working the snack bar, whatever, anything, you know. I actually had a small baseball field on our property for our team to practice on when I was younger. So I was really into baseball. And then,
what position did you play?
Shortstop.
Oh, yeah.
Buddy stop.
Yeah.
Shortstop. I played a lot of shortstop. I wanted to be a pitcher, but I wasn't that great at pitching, but I took every opportunity I could.
Was your childhood like that? I feel like you were on racing early. And
I was racing early, but I played baseball, and I actually tried to be the pitcher, but I really did stink.
Yeah, it was bad.
I liked baseball, but soccer was my sport.
Other stuff too.
Yeah, I did, yeah.
Because when I grew up, like you said, I grew up in Montana, a very small town, and it was seasonal. But when it was soccer season, you played soccer, you played football, you played basketball. I was on the swim team. I did karate. We snow skied.
Oh, wow.
I raced BMX.
You got me covered. Yeah.
But like everybody, I did probably more than most people, but like everyone played. You didn't specialize
right
at that age back then.
No, you didn't. No.
And it wasn't through, it was all through the school. Like now it's like you got to be on a club team. You know what I mean? It's just different.
Yeah, there's still there's still rec style soccer and baseball and football, but it's not good enough for anybody anymore. For
next level.
You got to go to the next level. I'm guilty of it. I mean, I put my son in travel baseball so early that I burned him out. And he was so good at it, but he didn't want to play anymore. Mm. He didn't want to commit because I was raised, once you commit to a season or something with a team, you're going to see it through.
Yeah.
They did like 72 games like 2 years in a row, like a pro season. And so I think in his little brain, he was like, you know what? That's a big commitment. So I'm just going to say no at the beginning I don't feel like I want to quit.
Well, that's
later.
A lot of sunflower seeds to eat through the season.
It sure is.
That'd be tough on your gums, you know?
Yeah, my gums are really tore up.
Yeah, the salt.
So
yeah.
Football, how much football did you play? How many seasons of that?
I played football, I mean, I was probably from four. I mean, I played on my brother's team before I was probably allowed to. You know, I wasn't old enough to play for real.
Tackle
football. Yeah. There was no such thing as flag football that I knew of back then, at least not in Tennessee. And no. So, yeah, from four, I played all the way up to junior high, and then I played the first year of junior high. But kind of walking this thing back a little bit when I was doing baseball and football and everything like that. You know, one day I was out riding in the yard, and my dad was coming. He trying to chase me down, going, "Hey, you have all-star practice today. You know, you got to get off your motorcycle and come in and go there." And I was like, "I don't want to go. I want to ride my motorcycle." And he was like, "You would rather stay here and ride your motorcycle than go to all-star," which we were kind of pointed towards the World Series. Just big deal. And I was like, "Yeah, I like this a lot better." And he was like, "Okay." So from that point on, he's all, "Finish this, and then you want to go racing, you want to do that? Let's do it."
So it's like you're saying earlier, your passion kind of came to you, and you're drawn to the motorcycle and the love and what it gave you adrenaline wise. Obviously, we're a bunch of adrenaline junkies, you know, and how it made you feel and the process of it. I was asking about football because it's one sport I didn't do, and I've always been intrigued by the structure of the football and the coaching and all that. And now being on this side of it, you know, coaching these young motorcycle riders. Like, that is a really good network of coaches and what you have to do, running plays and some sort of that. Did you learn a lot from that?
I think so. I mean, football is so structured. You know, there's a regiment. There's a brotherhood. There's a lot of cool things that come from it. And I think, you know, you have actually helped develop and apply some of those mainstream tactics into coaching on motorcycles, you know, different types of warm-ups and different things that actually are part of the game or part of racing. Mm-hmm. You do it in your warm-up, you know, just like every other mainstream sport. So I think you've done a good job of seeing little things like that and taking them over. And
thank you.
But I did, you know, I mean, when I was younger, I didn't pay that much attention to it, but I look at coaching football now, and I've coached my son since, you know, while I'm, you know, working at KTM and coaching riders on my own. I'm also coaching football. I've done baseball. I've done it all. Yeah. So I've done that side of it too. And I'm you know, I lay back. I know my lane. But as we get going, I know how to speak to kids and to parents. and you know, you start to learn and you start to know what motivates them, how to push them, how to get the most out of them. Right, just like any other sport. And I am impressed by football and what you know, at a young age. I mean, my son was young, and they were doing the same type of offense as the high school team, you know, and like they got these wristbands, and you're like, all right, you know, say a certain word that starts with a certain letter, and they know which where to go for the color, and then find the play, and then do it. And you and I'm just thinking in the beginning, I was like, these kids, they can't.
They're not gonna get this,
They got it. You know, and they just look at their little thing. You know, you call a play from the sideline. Hey, you know, say
Omaha.
Yeah.
Now he was Sticky Fingers T-Bone. What wasn't that? Did he get that from you, or wasn't it something like? Did he have a nickname like that?
No, he was good. He's a good receiver.
I know you use Sticky Fingers. Like he could just like Velcro or something.
Yeah, he was really good. He's actually a better athlete, like overall, than I was. But he, you know, he was so good at football and just did some spectacular things on the way up. But again, you love
basketball.
So I didn't force him into football, although I knew that, you know, as far as college opportunities and things like that, there's a lot more people on a football team or that they pull for football than basketball, you know? Mm-hmm. So there's a lot more opportunities. It's a lot easier to get a scholarship, but you can't force somebody to do something that their passion is not in there. Yeah. And back to that, like when I did all mainstream sports, and I loved it all. I really liked playing baseball. I really liked playing football, basketball. Like, I liked all of it, but when I did racing, it was a whole another level of light my fire, right?
Yeah, adrenaline, all that. So, you know, after that, missing that all-star practice and dad putting that you're going to, or Roy actually putting on, you're going to ride more dirt bikes, how long before you started really getting into racing from there?
Man, that's it.
Well, you broke your leg your fourth race, you said.
Yeah.
Did that deter you at all, or your parents?
Well, I broke my leg, and then a buddy of mine, not long after that, actually just riding in a field, hit a tree, passed away. Oh. So there was it was kind of like, you know what, that's not for me. You know, I like it, but it's not for me. I'm gonna do, you know, I was doing some mainstream stuff, but I got really into skateboarding and stuff like that. And then actually, my older brother, 3 years older than me, he started riding a little bit again, and I still had the bike that I had when I broke my leg. It was a KX80 at that time. And, you know, sitting in the garage, and my brother was riding, and he went to a local race, and he's like, oh, my gosh, you got to come back and try it. It's better than what we remember before, because he kind of peeled away from it too. Same thing. So I went to one race, and then I was like, oh, yeah, you're right.
That was it. Hooked you back.
Yeah, so right back in, and then – you know, just a local boy for...
What year would that have been? Just...
Oh, my gosh. See, this is the stuff.
I mean, ballpark. It doesn't have to be. Yeah. We're not going to fact check you.
Yeah. So, stats guy. That would have been... That was probably like 89, maybe.
Okay. All right.
Yeah. Because I did a few races in 87. That's when I broke my leg. Then in 89 is when I kind of got rolling again.
Okay.
And, you know, I was 15 years old at that point. And so we were just local, and then it was a big deal. We traveled.
Yeah, you're really late bloomer.
Late comer.
Yeah. So big deal. We went to Muddy Creek for the first time. We traveled out of, you know, our little 30-mile range area, and it was raining, and we just kept saying, this place really lives up to the name.
Muddy Creek.
And I got stuck going up the hill over there, and I had to come back down and try it again, and then my bike quit. I think I ran out of gas. So it was a...
Was that Roy's fault?
Probably, yeah. Yeah. So it wasn't a good experience, but I still loved it.
I still had fun.
We still had fun. So just started kind of slowly learning. This is my parents didn't know anything about racing, so they didn't know where to go or what to do.
Who were like the fast? Was there fast guys in your area? Like, was Mike Brown?
So Mike Brown was in the Muddy Creek area up there. So it wasn't until I started going there and seeing him and seeing his name, and there was guys like, well, you know, once I got to that area, you're talking like there was a guy named Kenny Kazar, old school racer, Keith Turpin, Garrett, and then you get into like the Jim Neeses. Jim Chester.
Jim Neese, his kid's racing now.
Luke
Neese.
I think he got 10th last week.
Yeah. I feel really old when I see these kids. Rick Ryan's kid.
Started traveling a little bit. Nothing like these families do these days. And then, you know, I went down to the Mini O's, raced that, and that was like, oh my, I couldn't believe it. Like, it was so many families and shocking. Just blew my mind, right? And then
did you do okay? Like, I the first time good. I went to the World Mini coming from Montana, 85. Oh, dude. I had my head up my head. I was like locked up, just like, whoa.
Exact same. Like, I didn't even sniff the top 10. I don't know what I got, but I wasn't even like, I was at the event, but I wasn't really part
of it. You participated.
Yeah, I participated.
You'd have got a ribbon.
These days I'd have got a ribbon. And then I went to Loretta's.
Which was how far from your house?
3.5 hours drive. And, you know, same thing, just eyes big, you know.
But you qualified and went.
Yeah, I qualified and went, and I was on an 80 at that point. And on the 80, I think I may have gotten like one top 10 or something like that, like throughout the whole week. And then I went back another time, only two times before I turned pro, to Loretta's, and I was feeling pretty good. I was in the B class and thinking, you know, I can be a top 5 guy. And whole shot of the first moto of the week and wadded in the Ten Commandments and got ran over and just beat up. And I still raced the rest of the week, but best I did was an eighth on that. And it's funny because when we went back in 2017, me and you, bud, first moto of the week. He was so mad at me.
I was so mad at him.
Yelling at me, and I couldn't even, like,
you went to,
hold
like,
my
the
head
back
up.
Class or something, or what'd you do?
Yeah, 40 plus, we 25 did. Plus. Yeah.
You raced too?
Yeah.
Oh,
you guys are crazy.
I got forced to. No.
It was fun.
I
made a bet, and then
Christy LaCurl, which was my boss at the time, she was the manager of Orange Brigade, and, you know, same position that I'm in now, pretty much. She put it in my contract.
That you had to go?
Yeah. And I was like, you know, she was like, when I handed her the contract back, she goes, did you read it? I was like, yeah, I saw it. But I was thinking the whole time it was like negotiable, you know, like, because I tried so hard to get out of it. Because I was like, I was always, when I'm done racing, I'm done. I'm not going to be that guy who tries to come back or goes, oh, gets a wild hair. I'll go do a pro national or whatever. Or because I look at Loretta's like, you got to be really ready for that event.
Yes.
So you have to prep. Almost the same.
We did. I mean, we had fun training together, riding together.
That part was fun.
It was, you know, coaching each other a little bit. Yeah. Like, it was really fun. And we get there and you know, Nathan gets a, I don't know.
How nervous were you? Dude, the nerves come back pretty hard.
The nerves came back, you know. The first one, I think after that, the 40 plus was pretty.
I mean, I always get a little bit nervous. I think that's part of what gets you going.
Yeah.
But it wasn't. It wasn't terrible. I mean, you know, it's like expectations. It kind of sucks because if you come back after having a pretty good career, everybody's like, oh,
Everybody thinks this guy's gonna win.
Well,
you're not at that level anymore, but you try to be.
So our good friend Christy, after she didn't trick me into it, but she forced me to go, basically tricked him into it because she did a bet with him. I don't remember what
the bet
was.
Yeah, the bet was I was doing a triathlon, just a small triathlon. It was a half-mile open water swim and then, you know, just a sprint. And she's never swam before. And so I was committed to doing it, and she's like, I'm going to learn to swim and do it. And open water swims aren't easy, you know, as far as just being comfortable, right? So I'm like, you know, if she goes and does that process of getting it, I'll take the bet and ride Loretta's. And
so she did it. You had to race Loretta's?
Yeah, and she did it. She crushed it, too.
Yeah. She's gnarly.
She's a stud.
Yeah, she is. Yeah. So I would have never made that bet. Because you know she's going to do what she sets her mind to anyways.
But the big thing with you is you're about losing your size, you know. Because once you start riding and training, you start shrinking. And he was going to, you know, I used to catch Nate looking at his muscles.
Oh, my gosh. Here we go.
He'd be walking off the track. There it is, you know.
Yeah, I was going to say, there's some empty whey protein bottles in Nathan's garage.
But I did,
trash.
I did lose probably 20 pounds to do Loretta's.
Yeah.
Like, so I got back closer to where I was when I raced. You know, still a little bit more, but... Yeah, we both got convinced to do it, and first moto.
Did you holy?
No, I was so real quick. Backing up, that same girl Christy, she put the word out that me and Bud are racing Loretta's.
So the brownie signs
so
up.
So Brownie's a Husky ambassador at the time or whatever. So of course Jenna from Husky goes, oh well, I'm gonna get my Husky guy to do it, and I was like, no, he's still like current. He's still racing.
Yeah.
He's for real. Me and him are just having
13
fun.
13 years for me,
We could care less who beat each other out of us, right? But then Brownie, it's like, oh, it got real serious. So I come out, he hole shots, I'm in second. And it was just a couple laps into it.
No, I think it was the first or second lap, he started doing the triple out of Storyland, which some of the pros are barely even doing. Him and Brownie started doing it.
We had done it the day before at practice.
But, you know, whatever.
It was a little wet.
He trying to keep it a little wet, you know, first moto. It was an early morning moto. And I just come through, and I'm probably sixth, seventh, and I just see Nathan going. over tea kettles, right?
Hard. Like, I would have been hurting. The younger version of me would have hurt at that one.
Yeah. You cased it, or like, what happened?
So, yeah, I thought I was fine. It was just a little bit still kind of slick. It was an early moto. A little bit slick, a little bit sticky. So I landed. I came up just a little bit short, and you kind of are leaning because there's a, you know, the track goes that way, and then there's a roller on the inside. So I was kind of just looking at that, and I just came up and just,
you were
like,
just down.
Before I knew it, yeah. I was like rolled up and just, you know, getting up. And I'm like checking myself. Oh,
I had him by the helmet at the end of it, just like, dude, we're just having fun here.
Yeah, he's in my face, and I'm still like, because I got back up. The bike was like this, right? And I'm going, I got all the Orange Brigade riders on the fence.
I got
watching
it.
Me.
Yeah, I can't.
And
oh,
I'm like,
man.
I don't know. But at that point, I'm like, I got to ride. So I first start riding thinking, I got to see if anything's broken because it feels like my chest was broken. You know?
My chest, all of it.
I'm like, I'm kind of rolling. I'm like, okay, that doesn't, nothing clicking. Hit a couple jumps. Okay, no, so I get going. So we end up in the impound area. He comes up to me. What are you doing? I told you. And I'm like, I didn't do anything. And he's like yelling at me like he's my dad.
That ride was impressive, though, that everyone told me. He came from a ways back, bars all sideways. Yeah. Typical Nate Dogg fashion. It don't matter whether he's, you know, 40-something or 20-something.
Where'd you get up to?
Ninth.
Really?
Yeah.
From a big digger.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I was hurting for 6 months.
How did
that.
The rest of the week go for you guys? I don't remember if I saw
I him. Had my hands full with Gruy and Karsten, you know. Probably,
those guys
probably
get
three,
it still.
Four, and, you know, and then the last moto, I finally got in a position with Nate and Brownie, and I was doing everything I could to hold Nate off, and he took me high after the sand. And
oh,
I don't remember that.
Dirty.
I mean, it was clean, buddy. I mean, he brought her in a little hot on me, you know.
I owed you from all those times you invited me to arena cross.
Yeah. Anyhow, yeah, he ended up getting away. Nathan, after that crash, you went twos the rest of the motos, didn't you, Swant?
I got some twos, except there was a mud moto.
That sucked.
And this is
part
funny.
Of why I would never go back to Loretta.
Yeah, so we get a mud moto. Me and him are scheming on the gate. We're like, hey.
Second, third gear.
Let's try third gear because I think this will work, right? Well, they quick dropped the gate, so I wasn't even ready, and I'm in the back of the pack, and I prepped my own goggles. So, I'm going around the first turn. I'm like, okay, got the tear off. Second turn, I'm just getting covered, right? Pull the string, and the lens pulls out.
Good goggle prep.
Who's like, my goggle guy?
Oh. Oh, it's me. That was kind of funny. So I'm like, ran off the track because I couldn't see. Get my goggles. I'm just like, oh. So then I get going. I don't remember what I got on that one, but
did you have to pull them off and put your legs?
Yeah, no, I rode without goggles.
Oh no, yeah.
that's my style. I can't stop. I don't have time.
I don't have time to protect these eyeballs. Let's just get racing.
I've done that so many times. It's so bad.
I don't have time.
But
it's true. I mean. You know, back in the day, you didn't stop for goggles, you know. But nowadays, they got the goggle exchange pretty on point, and you can see the difference when someone gets a clear set on the.
Oh,
they actually start making good
lap so
times.
Much
it's
better.
Pretty impressive.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, it depends on where you're at. If you're a few laps left, maybe you just pin it. But if you got a lot of race to go,
it was
man.
The start of the moto. Yeah, that was on the start.
Yeah, but you didn't have it. Who was helping you? Did you have like
a. No, I had a guy. I had one of the technicians from KTM.
He forgot to prep extra goggles for himself.
Probably. I don't know. I don't know if he. I can't remember. He probably had some, but he probably didn't have any.
You didn't have time for that.
Yeah, I don't have time.
Heck, at Loretta's, the dang signal area could be even worse than they scraped everything off over there. You might be in more trouble.
Yeah, that's a good point.
True. True. That's why
so
I didn't do it.
At what point had you met Bud and. Because you're friends with Ferry and. Like kind of that whole crew. When did you meet them?
Oh man,
94.
So,
I remember that. Yeah,
good deal. So was it? Are you sure?
I'm positive 94. Yeah, I was because I was on a Kawasaki still, and I was traveling with Timmy because I was staying out in Florida with Tishner, and then we were hitting Atlanta and Charlotte and a few of those rounds that were right in that circle, and we went over to this. Timmy tells me we're going over to Nathan Ramsey's house. I'm like, who?
Oh, you were living in Florida?
No. We went to Tennessee.
Oh, okay.
Because we were going to Charlotte next, I believe. Gotcha. You know, so. What, how many, 4 hours in Charlotte?
No, it's like six.
Is it six?
Either way.
You know,
80 cc's, 85,
yeah.
That's all.
Yeah. Going over to Nathan, so we show up there, and Nathan's got this this bold, kind of bowlish haircut, and Back then, and I swear by this, you know, his teeth had a little more in the front there, did a little bucky to him. You know, he's knocked those out a few times to get him, you know, Hollywood.
Okay.
And anyhow, I just hit it off with him and Bundy and his mom and dad. I mean, it was just like just this instant kind of family. You know, I think the first night I'm there, like, you're sleeping with Bundy. You know, or
spare bedroom, jump in with Bundy, the dirtiest one of the bunch.
Yeah. Put up the pill, pillow wall. But I mean, in the privateer life, that's what you did, you know, and that community, like sharing all that, you know, experience and helping each other out is part of it. And I remember Nathan had his track, supercross track, in back of there, back of his house.
The baseball field became a supercross track. Part of it.
And they had these whoops. And I was in the 250 class at the time, and Nathan's in the 125 class. And they're like, we never made them cross these whoops, right?
No, so look. So here's how we made the whoops, right? I had this big old piece of junk backhoe, right? And we had this like elevated little thing. And I was like, I had this bright idea. I'm like, I'm just going to back up, dig a trench.
Yeah.
Back up, dig a trench. So the whoops were shaped like this.
Yeah, they were coffins.
Yes, yeah. Exactly. So he wasn't even out yet. Yeah. I'll let you finish it, but this is the funny part to me. So it was me. I mean, Kevin Crine was there. Jean-Sebastian Waugh was there. I had a whole crew at my
house. Dougie Fresh.
Dougie Fresh.
Yep.
DeHaan.
Yep. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And he hadn't even came out to ride yet. And we all had our little turn trying to get through these whoops, right? We just, yang, 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 yeah. Everybody. Next guy. Ying, ying, yeah. I don't know. My parents, if I was thinking, if that was my kids out there, I would have been like, hey, no.
Well, there's still a kickstand thing. You know, your mom.
Yeah. So next thing you know, Budman comes out and, you know, we were just getting to know each other, and he comes out and he, I don't even think you stopped and talked to us.
No. Nah.
He just went like this. Right across the top of him.
Just blew your mind.
And we're all. We got to change these whoops so we can get through them. So we had to like shovel and make them more rounded and all that stuff. But
yeah, I mean, that was kind of the start of it, you know. Like obviously, I was on a 250 at the time, so the whoops were going to be a little bit easier for me back in the two stroke days.
He knew how to do it,
and I knew how to do it. I already did my share of over the bars, you know, learning how to skim whoops. So anyhow, started just working with them, actually trying to, you know, teach them some stuff, and then. Yeah. You know, and then they were getting around there better, and then Dougie and Nate take me on a run later, and they teach me a few things, you know. So it was just kind of this back and forth, you know, and, you know, of helping each other. Nathan gets to Charlotte, right, and, you know, you watch him ride at his track, just like that good lap time on Tuesday. You know, he's riding really good on his track, getting around it. We get to Charlotte, and the kid doesn't even make the main, you know, and you're just like,
was that your first race?
No, you've done
some before. Okay.
No.
I didn't even make the night show at my first race.
No.
First couple.
When was your first race? 93?
93. I raced. I was in the B class racing the Winter Am Series, and I finished Cocoa Beach event in the Winter Ams on Sunday, and I went to Tampa Supercross on Saturday, 6 days later. I don't know. You know, license, obviously, it was easy to get back then. And yeah, I didn't even make it. I didn't even make the night show, but I did take somebody out.
Oh, so you got that going.
I thought that was part of it.
But where I'm going with it is Nathan did not make the main event at Charlotte. But if you watch that guy ride every lap that he was on the track, he made the main 10 times over. Mm. You know, and that's been the kind of the storyline of Nathan's, you know, from my perspective, Nathan's career, you know, riding the bike bent up, not ever getting on any goggles. You've been that guy that the heart's always taken over everything that you've done. And so the heart's always came out in your riding. You know, I remember going from there. I don't remember where the next race was after that. But you kind of went in this back and forth of making a main, missing a couple, making one. And then you started to kind of click. I think what was it, 94 around Bud's Creek? 94, actually, you came out to California, right? And spent some time with me before it went to Hangtown.
What were you riding in 94?
That's another story, though.
Yeah, it is.
What were you riding in 94?
94 I was on a Yamaha. It's just a shop deal, you know. Yeah. So I came out to California. I think what happened is I came out to race Hangtown because I was in the mindset back then is like, if I show up at all the races and people get used to seeing me and get to know me, I'm gonna start to know more people. They're gonna expect to see me, and then, you know, I might get some type of sponsorship yeah. along the way because I'll be more considered because, yeah. hey, this guy, he's not doing that great, but yeah.
he's there.
He's there. So we went to Hangtown, if I'm remembering right. We did Hangtown, and then you were like, hey, you know, Bundy is me and Bundy in the box fan.
Oh, yeah.
And at that point, I was ready to kill Bundy because we were together too much. We wanted to kill each other. And I'm like, I think we came back for like a week or something. Maybe it was Glen Helen next or something.
I don't remember the schedule. All I know is you know, kind of paying the privateer thing forward. Nathan came out this way. Hey, come stay at my house with me and Shelly. And I think at the time, you're right. You needed some time away from Bundy. And Bundy was going to go back to head towards Bud Creek, and you were going to stay with me, right?
Well, yeah, so there's a little more to it. So we came back for, and I'm guessing it was another race that next weekend and whatever. So Budman had said, yeah, stay with me, no problem. I think it was me and Bundy.
Yeah.
And then throughout that week and after that, I was like, he was like, man, I was like, I'm learning so much out here. You know, it's too bad. I got to go. And I think I said it around the group because mm-hmm. Emig was around. You know, he's one of Buddy's good friends at the time. And Jeff was like, dude, just stay with me. You want to stay longer? Stay with me. And I was kind of like, and I'm still this kid from Tennessee going like, you know, this dude, like, factory guy, yeah. you know. And but we had kind of got past that because we'd been around each other a lot. And, you know, and McGrath was around. Like, it was a whole crew of guys that you know them all.
I got brought in because of RL living right. with him. But it was the right. same thing. I'd yeah. be like, man, I can't believe I'm at Emig's yeah. Halloween party right now. You
know? Exactly.
Getting stiff-armed by Budman.
Yeah. Yeah, so Emig was like, dude, just stay with me. And I'm just like, that's awesome. Like, for sure, I'm going to do it. And I wanted to get away from Bundy anyway. So I sent Bundy on. And I think it was after maybe the first day or so. We gave it a little bit of time. And I was sitting with you. And I was like, hey, you know, Jeff offered for me to stay. I let Bundy leave. And he hasn't said anything. I don't want to go, hey, man, you said I could stay with you. When can I come over? You know?
Got his pillow in his hand.
Yeah. You're like, hey. And you were like, hey, don't worry about it. He's like that, you know, just stay with us. Yeah. So I stay with you, and yeah. then I became Bailey's boyfriend.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Oh, yeah. How old was Bailey then?
Like, oh, she was young.
Two.
Yeah, two.
Three.
Yeah.
Doing
yeah.
head whip, ponytail
yeah,
whips.
Oh, yeah. Bailey put on a little show dancing, and she loved Nathan, and her head whip spins were mm-hmm. were impressive. You know, the also cool thing is just, like, the family vibe that we've always had and is how Nathan would just get down on the floor and
yeah,
play
just
with
dive
it.
Right
yeah,
in.
Dive yeah. right in, you know. And so it made that connection really good. And, you know, we had a lot of fun with it over the years.
So how did that season then turn in? Because you got the Yamaha or the Suzuki ride in 95?
97.
Oh, 97. Okay.
Yeah. So there's still yeah. some more moving dirt through 95. And oh, yeah. 96 was his
kind of breakout?
Yeah, when you got on the Suzuki at that time. In 96, yes, you were on a Suzuki. And I remember showing up, I don't know if Atlanta was the first East or whatever, one of those. I mean, the first round, and watching Nate, and he's still got that big heart out there. But he's actually starting to put things together, you know. And you're like, all right, look at him go. Orlando might have been the first. Or Tampa.
I think it was one of those two. And I think, yeah, you're right, like that went pretty good for me. I'm pretty sure I got.
You got a fourth or something. Yeah.
I think it was
yeah.
fourth. Yeah. I got fourth there. And then the next race was Minneapolis for some reason.
You're right. Yeah. Yeah.
Went to Minneapolis. Didn't make the main event.
Yeah. After a fourth?
Yeah.
So
just crashed?
I crashed yeah. in the heat race, something whatever. And then I was in like fifth or sixth, actually. Fifth or sixth. And there was one of those where you did the start and you went straight into whoops. But on the laps, you came across the backside of the berm, landed, and then hit the whoop. So you could get a lot of speed coming in. And it was the last lap. I looked up. I could see fourth place, and I was like, I'm
how many gears does this thing have?
Yeah. Exactly. I didn't care at all. Just came off the backside of that berm. And then I was like flying through the air. Like everything slowed down for a second. And I was like, oh, why did I do that?
This was a bad idea.
Right. Didn't make the main. I was probably ready to kill myself.
Daddy, I'm in the air.
Yeah. Probably ready to kill myself. And yeah.
That was 96?
Yeah. That was 96.
95?
No, that was 96 probably.
96, yeah. 96 is when he started breakout. That's when. And then
96 was the East West shootout at Minneapolis. So, because there was multiple, it was that one.
Yeah, maybe
that might have been part of why
maybe that was
so hard for me to make the main. Yeah, and that same year is when was that?
Yeah,
because that was 97.
That would make sense because it was the opening round for the West that year, and it was the second round for the East Coast. So you would have went from Orlando or whatever to.
I think it was Orlando, but I'm not positive.
Yeah. Well, that was the year too in '96. Like he started.
Because Jeremy won in factory, got second, right? At Orlando.
At Orlando, yes.
So
that is true.
That was that year.
Yeah. Mm. And then skipping forward through, he started breakout through the. He started breakout through the 125 class, and then he decided to do a 250 race at Denver. Was the last round in '96, and I remember that little sucker with his whole pin it through. They had these little small whoops, but they were tough, right? And I beat him in the heat race. I think you were right behind me or something like that. And sure as crap, lap 17 or so, here comes Nate Dogg by me. You know,
in the main.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was 96, huh?
You know, I mean, knowing I had ridden a whole 250 season and I was, you know, in the top 10 and doing fairly good for myself, you know, but having, you know, a 125 rider come up to 250 class and just the brashness that you had to just go for it. Did you have to, like you're talking about going, how many gears does this thing have? Did you have to put yourself in a headspace to do that, or did it just came all from?
Well, I respected the 250 more than the 125, so I didn't do that on the 250.
Yeah, I know, but to have that kind of like three laps to go, you know, we're both on the limiter. Like,
well, you've always been, like you said, full of heart. Like when I watch you ride, it's all heart. I mean, you practice and work hard enough that you put the technique together to get it done, but it's all like right here, you know.
Yeah, well, I appreciate that because that's kind of where I come from. You know, my dad, like whatever sport I was playing, it was like I never got in trouble for whatever place I got or however I played a baseball game or football game if I tried as hard as I could.
Yeah,
that was all I had to do, and I'd never be in trouble. So that kind of just, you know, strung over into racing, obviously. And you know, I really, like, when people would ask me, what do you want people to remember you as a racer? And I was like, just somebody who never gave up. That was kind of my deal. So it's great. It's really great to hear you guys say that. And I think it also came a little natural too. Like I didn't have it in me to like ease off. Even when I play golf, like when somebody's, hey, hit that shot 50%. And I'm like, how do you do 50%? You know, I have trouble with that.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, now that I'm older, it's a little bit better, but that was just kind of my mentality too. And then being brought up that way just kind of escalated it. And, you know, I think that the heart got me through the early years a lot, you know, just to propel me. Cause I knew I started late and I knew that I had a lot of work and a lot of catching up to do and tried to be around a lot of guys who knew a lot of stuff. And then, you know, with Budman, he took me under his wing from day one, you know, at my house, you know, and started giving me little tips and then started working with me more regularly. And then I was starting to put some technique with that heart, which, you know, I could never lose the heart. You know, I needed that the whole time too, because I wasn't that talented as a rider. You know, I would listen, and I was never, you know, I was always open. Like I never thought,
that's a good point.
He's not
openness,
you know. Yeah. I try to tell my riders now, don't ever think you know it all. Mm. And if someone suggests something to you, even if you think they're a kook or whatever, it's worth a try, you know? Yeah. You know, there's some core things but that you don't want to go away from. But
well, and I'll use Rhino as a perfect example, because if you watch his Instagram, you know, you get a little wild at times and you think this guy's lost his marbles, but he has some really great nuggets of technique and things. Like, that guy's really got some good stuff.
He really, really does.
So I think that's great, man. There's a saying, it's like a wise man can learn from a fool, but a fool will learn from no one.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
You can pick something up from anybody. I go watch, you know, I could watch an intermediate kid or an 80 rider.
Yeah.
Go, wow, did you see the way he did this? You know, I'm going to try that.
Yep.
Yeah.
So be a student. You know, I like that.
Yeah.
So
absolutely.
Going back to the question I was asking you, because I really want to know this, because I played other sports with you, you know, and he starts running his mouth towards the end.
A little chirpy.
Little chirpy, you know. So, like, with three laps to go, are you talking yourself up, running, you know, I'm going to get Budman, or he ain't got nothing for Nate Dogg.
Yeah, what was in your head when you're coming up
I don't talk trash under the helmet, like, to myself to hype myself up. But
why do you do it in other sports? I mean, it only works
fine.
In other
sports. It's fine. I see your reaction. I think that I always struggled with belief in myself, you know, like believing that I belong, because I always put these guys on pedestals. And like, just like you said, you may have some of the same thought process, but I was always like, so I'd show up at a race almost going like, dude, hope I fit in. But then when we get on the track and things would start to happen, I'd be like, this ain't that bad. This isn't that hard. So constantly through a race, I was actually
building confidence.
Yes. The belief was getting stronger. And then in the end, it was like, shoot, I can get it there and pass that guy. I mean, in that same race, yep. I could not believe it, but I was also battling with Mike LaRocco, yep. and Greg Albertine.
Yeah, we were around some good guys. Yeah, it was pretty impressive.
And I'm just going, how am I still here? You know, and just, and it was altitude. So that played in for me because I, you know, for whatever reason, I could always push myself far. Yeah. And I remember Denny before the main event up there. I don't think he went with us, but the ambulance was sitting down there, and he's like looking around. He goes, "Hey, let's go get some oxygen before we start this." And I was like, "Okay." So forever, I thought the oxygen is what gave me the push to finish the main event. So pretty good stuff.
I didn't know that. That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Do you know where you finished that night?
Eighth.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. As a 125 guest rider, that's pretty good, man.
It was super impressive.
So would you say, at what point was there like a breakout ride or race or season for you?
So
I mean, that obviously so pretty with, dang good right there.
Yeah, and then that was, you know, it was a one-off deal. I just did it, you know. But I had a couple podiums that year, you know, that made it feel like, okay.
And you were on a Suzuki, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, privateer Suzuki.
So that actually, okay, yeah.
Was
so
it FNS or I'm trying to think of who was it?
Performance Engineering, I think, was that year, wasn't it? Which is Wynn Kern, who now owns and runs Mini O's, Gatorback, that whole deal.
Oh,
he
okay.
owned Performance Engineering. So I think it was Performance Engineering. It might have been a little, I may be getting that mixed up. But it was a Suzuki, it was just a Suzuki privateer deal, which I had some support, you know, along the way with that. But then that year caught the eye of a few people. So I was in the talks, and then Primal Impulse Honda approached me, basically offered me a deal. I'm sitting in my living room and couldn't believe I was about to get paid to ride a motorcycle, you know. So sky high from that offer. I would have said yes to anything they said, but. You know, it was a pretty good deal. $24,000, right? $2,000 a month. And I'm like, I'm Rick James. and then I got a bike, I think, from another rider that was on the team. They kind of passed it to me on the East Coast. And I was waiting for my contract. And it kept stalling. And I had already heard rumors, you know, that people been promised things. And so I was a little nervous and checking in. And finally, I ended up making the trek out to California. Me and Bundy came, and I had the Honda with me, and I'd been riding it, and I ended up getting an apartment. Well, I didn't get an apartment. Tim Ferry and his mechanic had an apartment in Corona, and I was meant to just stay there, but then it was like, hey, I got an extra room, we got this. So I was like, okay, well, let's all split it. We'll all just live here, right? And so I was going to live there with Tim Ferry. It was Tim Ferry and his mechanic upstairs. I forget. We must have bought a small bed, and I just jammed it in Timmy's room, and we slept in the same room.
Okay.
And then Bundy, my mechanic, you know
Bundy
how you walk in an apartment and you got the kitchen, normal layout, kitchen, little living room, stairs going up into the top part, and then there's that closet right there that goes under the stairs.
Yeah. He did not.
That's where he slept. Yeah. With a little blow up mattress.
A little rat nest. And
oh, it was so nasty in there. You open the door in the morning, it smelled like just breath, and it was nasty. So that's where
Bundy.
I lived. Bundy.
Bundy.
And so that's where I lived in 97. And I'm still waiting on my contract, And then all of a sudden, I don't know if it was Lee, because Lee McCollum was Timmy's mechanic at the time. It was either him or Timmy comes home, and they're like, hey, Suzuki's looking for a 125 West Coast guy. It was super last minute. Like, would you be interested? And I'm like, well, yeah, but I got this other deal. But, I mean, of course, it's a factory ride compared to, like, a satellite deal, right? And so they're like, all right, well, let me see. Let me see if I can set up a little meeting. So I went in, and Roger DeCoster was the manager at the time. But he didn't meet with me because he didn't want another rider. He already had four. He had Timmy, LaRocco, Albertine and Jeremy.
Oh, nice. McGrath.
Oh, that's yeah.
right. Yep. Right, so he didn't. I get it now, but in the beginning, I was offended, you know, because I'm like, well, why didn't you need a West Coast guy? Anyway, I went in there. I met with Hide, who was there back in the day, right? And literally, he just asked me a few questions and pushed a contract in front of me, right there, and I was like, oh,
done.
Had a contract. It was exactly the same, 24 grand. But I was factory. I was a factory rider. Was not ready for it, but. I wasn't going to say no. And
how good's that feeling?
Oh, it was good. But at the same time, I'm going, what am I about? I got to go to Honda and tell them.
Oh, yeah.
So I'm like, okay, get my box van, bike in the back, drive over there.
Where was Bundy?
Bundy didn't go with me on this. I don't know where he was.
He was in his closet.
But he got to go to Suzuki with me.
Yeah.
You know, he got to go with me to Suzuki. And I don't know if he was going with me to the Primal Impulse team or not. I can't remember that. He might remember. But so I'm going to Honda. Get to Honda. I go in and, man, I can't remember the guy's name that was there that I was dealing
was
with.
Was it Mike Raring? Was he the
no.
guy?
That's
no, going? that was later at Primal.
Yeah.
Okay.
Really? No, this was a Honda guy. I'm dealing straight
at
Honda.
Okay.
At Honda.
Because Primal had Honda factory support at the time.
Yeah, it was a pretty solid team.
When Renard was on him, right?
Yeah.
Before that,
Ashkenazi.
But just before, yeah. So,
well, 90,
gosh, it wasn't Chuck Miller. It was some guy who it was. I can't believe it. I can't remember. His name,
well, 97's when I signed for Arena Cross with Billy Whitley in the Tough team, and then I went outdoors with Primal Impulse on a 250, and it did have Renard and Sean
Parolio.
Parolio.
Mm.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Anyhow.
Anyway,
and so
whoever the guy
back
was
to, he was
going,
he was the
Lee
salty
Edmonds?
Guy. No, no.
Okay, I'm trying to think. Of
he was on. He was grumpy. He was intimidating, right? So I had to go in and tell him, "Hey, here's your bike back." I mean, I wasn't going in to ask any questions. I was just going in to say thank you. I've done something different.
Was it dirty or washed?
Probably dirty. I have no idea. And went in there, and I'm sitting with him, and I tell him, "Look, you know, I couldn't say no. I've been waiting on a contract. You know, I was real. I'm sure I looked." Nervous and scared, but I was like, I'm really sorry.
Nervous and scared.
Yeah. I'm sorry, but this is a factory ride, and they had the contract right there. I signed it. It's done. I'm going to ride for Suzuki. And he let me have it. Like,
is that right?
You will never be anybody in this sport. You're burning bridges. You're nobody already. Blah, blah, blah. That's why I wish I could remember his name, because he lit me up, right? He's like, you'll never ride for Honda. You'll never be anybody in this sport. And I was just like, what did I do? You know, I believed him. Like, I'm just.
Keep in mind, he still got the buck teeth at this time. You know,
did you have the bowl haircut? The pumpkin pie haircut? I got to see a picture of this.
And he had a little bit of an accent still at the time.
Yeah.
Too, so
yeah.
He was still some country in him.
Yeah, a little hillbilly. So I left there with my tail between my legs, worried, like, oh, what did I do? Then took the Suzuki deal and had a horrible year. Did horrible for factory riders. I was like, you know.
The one highlight I remember is you casing a triple at Seattle and going flying.
That was the one thing that got me the deal with Pro Circuit. So I led until 12 laps in. That's the one where Wyndham ran off on the concrete and slid out. And then he went to pull back on the track, and someone clipped him. I forget who clipped him.
I remember that. Okay.
Right? They clipped him. And so and he did that early on. So I'm leading this thing. And I had a little bit of a gap, and it was rutty. Like, it was gnarly.
Oh, yeah.
You know, 125 days ruts. And I remember there was this one rut right by the hay bale back then. And it was good at first, but it was getting kind of, like, deeper, and it was kind of had a bend in it, right?
Boy.
And so that lap, I got, like, I caught the middle of it a little bit too. So right at the top, I was like, and I was like, ring, 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 and just.
Ooh. Did you have that slow motion feeling again?
Oh, yes. Yeah. And then I land, one, and then Roncada was behind me, you know, and he hit my bike and he crashed, and Villeman won his first supercross that night.
Oh, okay.
And the same thing. I'm on the plane going home, ready to kill myself. And actually, was pretty cool. Jack and Ann McGrath were on the flight. You know, I was on the team with him, and everyone was always so nice to me. And they were like, you know, I just, you see it on my face. Like, I was just so devastated. And they were like, don't worry about it. Like, you're going to be fine. You're going to do that again. You'll get there. You know, super nice to me. I just remember that moment on the plane going, that's McGrath's parents trying to cheer me up. That's pretty cool. Because my parents were always very positive. Like, it was, we never focused on the negative. It was always the positive stuff.
That's
very
important, I think.
Yeah.
You got to touch on the negative, but the positive is the end result. And if there is positive in there, that's what's going to take you in the direction you need to go.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yep.
Are you sure the highlight of that season was, and it wasn't a great season for him, it wasn't in Vegas, and you had a flight home, but Roger called you and had you drive the team car back home?
Well, the highlights would have been before that drive, but yeah, that was pretty nice too.
He's like, Roger really doesn't like me. I got to drive the car home.
Yeah. I think it was a rental van or something.
I don't know what it was, but I remember, you know, I think we went out after the race or whatever.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. He tells you to drive a van back? Mm-hmm. I need you to just bring this car back for me.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. He was so mad.
Yeah. I was so mad, and then I took the wrong way, like the quickest way to get to Buddy's house. I didn't go that way, and I'm like making it longer. And I was like half asleep, been up all night. Yeah, it was rough. But that little moment is what caught Mitch's attention.
Okay.
Yeah. So then the next step was Mitch slaughtering me when he's talking to me, asking me about a ride.
Oh, yeah.
That's a good story, too.
Let's hear this one. How did this go?
So from that, it was like the end of the season, you know, and I had been to the river with Buddy and the crew. Well, I think one other time, maybe. I think the first time I ever came to California, they introduced me to the river.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, I love this place. This is nice. And so I'm like, Mitch is like, hey, can you come by Pro Circuit? I want to talk to you. And I'm like, okay, yeah. And he was like, come by next Wednesday. And I was like, I can't. And I didn't really know the stigma around it as much either. And I'm just like, I'm going to the river. Can I come by on Tuesday or whatever day it was, you know, before that, right? And he's like, yeah, that's fine. And so I go in there and I'm like talking to him. And he's like, well, what do you think about your year? I was like, yeah, it wasn't good, you know. Had some moments. Because also I broke my arm. That was back when, during that season, it was Gatorback Pro National happened before Supercross was done.
Yeah.
So I did the Gatorback Pro National, brain faded on the last lap of that big elevator jump.
Yeah, the elevator.
I just sent it and like, oh no, like we don't jump this jump. and I just, boom, I bounced off of it and I hit so hard, like my whole body hurt. It was the last lap when I packed it up, was bummed out. Again, bummed, you know, factory rider, not doing very good. And then
you
I was
and like, me should have hung out because I wasn't doing that good that year either.
I remember buying you some ice cream a couple times.
Yeah, I think you did have to talk me up.
Hey, you bought me some ice cream, too.
We owe Bud some ice cream.
Cheer you guys up after them motos.
Yeah, so then like 2 or 3 days later, I was, you know, staying with Ferry in Florida because the next race must have been Daytona Supercross, something like that.
It always Tampa, went, Daytona.
It always went Gatorback and then Daytona and then back into Supercross. Yeah.
So we were riding more of a Supercross-style track, and it was like first or second lap, and it was a tiny little double, and I went like, got a little bog, bing, and nose picked it, but didn't crash, but broke my arm. Mm. So during that season, I also broke my arm. Yeah. So by the end of the year, when I'm in there talking to Mitch, and he's like, okay, well, what do you think about your season? I'm like, it wasn't very good. You know, I had a rough time. I don't think I was ready, but I learned a lot, blah, blah, blah.
Looking forward to going to the Riv tomorrow.
I was like, and he was like, well, would you like to be, you know, I'm like, well, yeah, I would want to ride on your team, you know, that stuff. And he was like, why are you going to the river? And I was like, just, you know, season's over, made it through, you know, just a little cap off to the year. And he's all, but why? And I was like, I'm like, well, just, I must have said, just a reward for finishing the season. And he was just like, a reward. And he gets his results out, you know, and he's just like,
get the binder.
Look at this. You suck. You were horrible. And I was just kind of like, I didn't know what to say. And then, so we kind of finish up. And he goes, okay, well, when you get back from the river, come back in and we'll talk some more. And I was like, okay, boom, to the river.
Yeah.
Have my fun. And then whatever day it was, I get back, I go meet with Mitch, and he's giving me a hard time about the river. What'd you do at the river? Yeah, you know, just really grilling me, you know. And I'm honest, so I'm saying the stuff for the most part, you know. And
He appreciates that, though, to be honest with you. Makes you appreciate you kind of being candid with him about what's going on.
Yeah. He would much rather that than you try to fake it. But so he goes, oh, I know what you're doing. He has a Polaroid picture of me at the river on the sandbar.
No.
With some girl dancing on the back of the boat, and I'm wearing some stupid-looking hat with beer in my hand. And he's like, yeah, I know what you're doing. And he's showing me. And I'm just like, and I know Phil was standing there, like, you know, like, and
I'm all like, the usual suspects.
First of all, I'm just in my mind. I'm going, how in the world? How did he get this? Who's watching
97,
me?
I was probably there. Phil took me to Havasu for the first time in 97, and that was the first time I ever drank alcohol. Got me drunk at Kokomo's. I was all, Phil, I'm dizzy.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sure. I did a lot of crazy stuff there in the cooler. Not just grabbing beers out of them.
One time I had to pack him up and back in my truck because he wouldn't wake up, so I just put him in the back of my truck. And he wakes up, we're eating. Oh, I'm hungry.
It was like the tent, everything in the back of his truck, and I'm just laid out on top of it. It was definitely against the law, riding in the back like that. But, yeah, so Mitch is giving me a hard time. But ultimately, he ended up going, look, I want to give this thing a shot, blah, blah, blah. I got a deal. Got my first deal with him. And, man, he was hard on me, really, really hard on me.
So from talking to Mitch, you two butted heads pretty hard at a point. I don't know when it was. That's what I want you to get into. And you guys had a come to Jesus meeting that actually changed Mitch permanently in the way he dealt with riders. And I want to ask you about that conversation because he'll say, yeah, Nathan and I just, we were doing this. And like, it sounds like, and I want you to tell me the conversation, but it sounds like you kind of stood up to him and said, look, dude, you yelling at me isn't helping. And whatever you said got through to him because he kind of went, okay, I can't treat everybody like Rhino, you know?
Yeah.
No one, not everybody likes to be screamed at.
Yeah.
Because trust me, I rode there for 95, 6, and 7. I got screamed at a bit.
Yeah. So I really believe he thought the river guy, like how the whole thing got set up in me, he thought that's who I was. I really wasn't that guy. It really was like the only time all year that I was doing anything like that.
Yeah.
You know, I was pretty dedicated or, you know, I was pretty headstrong when it came to all that. You know, I picked my moments and they were very few at the time because I knew I started racing late and I only had a certain amount of time I needed to get it done. I didn't have time for that really. So he thought that's who I was. So he's just constantly on me, like just, you know, you don't try, you're a partier, blah, blah, blah. You know, he just thought that's who I was, you know.
Throughout 98, throughout the season?
This is, like this was like, I mean, I went and did some arena crosses up there with Buddy and didn't win. I don't even know if I was on the podium. I probably was here and there, but
I think you were. Yeah.
Come back and he would rip into me like, you want to race supercross? You want to ride on my team? You can't even go win an arena cross? Like just killing me. Like, and so there came a point where, like, I'm sitting here going, like, what am I doing? I don't want to ride for this guy. Like, I remember telling my parents, I probably told you, like, I can't stand him. I can't stand him. He doesn't, like, I don't want to win for him. I don't want to do good for him. He doesn't deserve to have someone do good and give him credit because he's the worst person I've ever met. So I'm thinking that, and I'm, like, literally going, like, I would go somewhere else if I had an opportunity. I would leave Pro Circuit. And he kept pushing and pushing and pushing, and one day I finally said all that stuff to him. Like, listen, you are the worst person to ride for. You think that all you got to do is yell at somebody. You think that telling me I effing suck is going to make me better. I'm not that guy. I'm not that type of guy. You have to do it different. Like, you can't just yell at everybody and use the same method and not, and expect a, you know, a different result out of somebody who works different. And, I mean, I just told him, if I win, I don't want you getting the credit. Like, Bob,
you really let it out.
Yeah. I said everything that I was thinking. And he was kind of like
intimidating
this
guy. So that's not easy to do. You had to have been fed well.
Oh, and it takes a lot to get me there. Yeah. So I was there, and at that point, I was like, I didn't care. I didn't want to ride for him. So I said all that, and everything changed. And then all of a sudden, I take that back. I said all that, and then he also made he made everybody do the VO2 max test. Falsetti was the guy back in the day. I'm sure you did it. Yeah. So I did that and, you know, Falsetti. Scored really good on that.
I haven't heard that name in since 90s.
I can't believe I remember that name.
Yeah. You're going to need a nap afterwards.
I know. I'm sweating. So, yeah, I did that. It was right around that same time frame. And, I mean, the switch flipped and
You were talking about your scores. Your scores were really high.
Yeah, it was like elite category on everything. And then when they were like, you know how when you're doing it, whether you're running or bicycling, they're like, tell us when you can't go anymore. And literally, I just kept going. And they were like, tell us when you can't go. And I think I was like at like 215 or something heart rate. And they're just like, they just stopped me.
Is that right?
Because I just was like, I'm not stopping until I fall off.
Yeah.
And so that went well. And then I think he started going, wait a second. Like maybe this kid isn't who I thought he was, you know, and then I was pretty good at testing too, so we started developing a better relationship through testing because I would almost test everything for everyone, and then it just like all of a sudden, you know, he knew that I was working hard and he still gave me crap, you know, like it wasn't like he just stopped, but it was like all of a sudden we were working together, and I was getting better and he was getting knowing how to treat me better and whatever, you know. And then ultimately, you know, ended up, you know, being – see, this that was 98. So I can't remember what the highlights were from 98 as far as
like, I'm pretty races. Sure you had some good results because that was like a breakout year for you in terms of results. You kind of – maybe it wasn't consistent, but you had some good races.
Probably most definitely wasn't consistent because I was fast, but I crashed a lot.
Yeah, crashed a lot. I think you crashed again in Seattle in 98 possibly or someone like – I remember leading something in 98.
Yeah, probably.
Were you west in 98?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And in 99. But 99 is when I won my first race, you know. So it kind of all led up to that first win in 99, which, you know, the first race of the year, I broke a chain. And, you know, Mitch, you know, it's everything's about the championship. I broke my chain at Anaheim for the first event of the year and just was like, this is it. I'm not even in the running, you know. Mm-hmm. But Casey Johnson was winning. He was in the points lead. And I won Phoenix, which was it the second or
second
third
round? Yeah, it was the second.
Second or, was it second?
I think so.
And I won there and it was just like everything changed, you know. And then Casey ended up, he hurt himself a couple races later. I won Seattle after that. Yeah. I won like six races after that, you know. And then at the championship one, you won.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that was a good one. I remember you singled the finish line. I didn't even know it was checkered flag.
Yeah.
And I sent it over your head like. And then it was like, and I'm like, everyone slowed down. Why they slowed down?
Yeah. Oh, dude, I was nervous because I hadn't won in a minute.
Mm-hmm.
Since 95, you know, I was like. I got to hold on to this. And we hit lappers at the end.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't that crazy how you win and then you get a couple and it's pretty easy. But if you go on any kind of like dry spell, right?
Mm-hmm. It's almost like
that next one back is more nerve wracking than the very first one.
Yeah.
In fact, in the video, Bailey even says, I don't know who's nervous, more nervous right now. Yeah. Ramsey trying to get his first title or Pinger trying to get his second win.
Yeah.
Well, Nathan just went to that headspace where he just went, you know, don't even see your checkered flag. Wait till Bundy stops.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I couldn't.
Like Forrest Gump like, running. Just stop,
I was like, dude,
Nathan.
He just singled. I got the lead now. Like, that's what I was thinking. Like, why'd he single that?
Why is he doing a one-hander and casing the finish line double?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah.
That was, that had to feel, like, what was that feeling, man? Like,
I mean, it was awesome, and I did give tons of credit to Mitch, and you know, because I said the tides changed anyways, but you know, I mean, it was, you know, I got taught a really good work ethic from a guy named Tim Topham that owns Mark IV. It's a dealership in Withfield, Virginia, somebody that I lived with and stayed with and rode out of his place. He taught me a lot too as far as working hard and, you know, along with everything that my parents taught me growing up, but I learned a ton from Mitch too, and you know, I learned every end of it, you know what I mean, from testing better to how important all the little details are, and you know, testing with Bones was obviously amazing. He's basically an artist, you know, and then just the long days. And, you know, I mean, I remember sitting out there, like, it was a grind, but I can remember sitting there going, man, I'm so lucky to do this, you know. And these guys were fun, and, you know, Bundy be bent over working on the bike, and Mitch would roll by him and take a T-handle and just dink right in his head. And, like, he just loved to pick at people and just, like, get them riled up. So, yeah, all that stuff was good. And then to finally get there and, you know, get the championship, and it took a minute for it all to, obviously, to sink in, and how close it was to slipping away, really. You know, Casey Lytle, who I work with now, you know, he cased a jump on with a lap and a half to go. Because you were leading. He was in second. I was in third. He was going to win the championship.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah. Yep. Yep. So he cased a jump, and it was also controversial.
It was that close?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, you remember now. I didn't.
I think it was a two-point difference. So if he would have got second and I would have got third, he would have won, because there was the difference in
more race wins, right?
Yeah. But he came up short on a jump, and I got by him, and then I was still focused on you. But then it was controversial because it was Billy Payne, who was one of the lappers, who was a teammate of mine.
That's right. I remember
and,
that drama.
You know, there was a, you know, I didn't know it at the time, but later I looked back on it, and, you know, I could see kind of based off of our intro conversation, lappers, and, you know, I mean, that's something that probably plays through Casey's head, you know. It worked out for me, but it could have went the other way just as easy. And, it wasn't anything that Billy was trying to get in his way, but he happened to be close on the track when Casey cased the jump.
So
who knows if that was a difference maker. But, yeah, it was a great feeling. I mean, you know, something that I always wanted and dreamed of, but I didn't think it was going to happen for me, you know. But winning that first race at Phoenix changed everything, because this, you know, the snowball got rolling, and then it was just like, that's what I expected, you know.
I'll tell you this, because my first race win was at San Jose, the last round of the season. There was just Vegas, so like I won San Jose, then went to Vegas, I think I got third, and then we hit the Nationals and I sucked. I never got a chance to like really build on that momentum, and I made some bad personal choices. Dating life, if you recall, in that timeline. But I wonder if there's something to that. Winning a race earlier in the season to where you can go, like you said, your mindset clicks into, I can do this. This is what I want to do now every time. And at Vegas, in my year, I was sick as a dog that night where I got third. So, like, I just didn't get a chance to really use that as to, like, springboard into more.
It makes sense.
Well, it makes totally sense. I've never seen somebody that's won the last race of the year, then all of a sudden they're coming out and stomping it the next year. Like, I've personally never seen that. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's great to win the last race of the year, but usually that person that wins early and wins a few often gets that ball rolling and starts to get the confidence and starts to put things together in a championship form, you know?
Yeah. I would have to agree with that. That's a good kind of thought process. Like,
well, let's go out and win early.
Yeah. You know, like, don't wait, like, you know.
How did the summer go for that year? I can't remember how you did 99 in the summer.
Not good. I was kind of same as you. Like, I switched. So motocross, believe it or not, like, supercross came easy to me for whatever reason. Easier, I should say. Like, motocross, everything had to be perfect. I had to be, like, hitting my marks. You know, like, the bike had to feel perfect to me for me to get a good result. It's just, like, everything had to align. And in supercross, I could jump on anything and be pretty competitive, you know. So I went in, everyone, you know, expected a lot out of me in outdoors that year, and I didn't do very good.
Well, isn't that, see, now I would have thought you'd be a good outdoor guy, because growing up in Tennessee, you got mud and ruts. I always use the excuse, well, I grew up in Arizona, we didn't have mud. And if it was muddy, I waited for it to dry up. Yeah. Like, I never went out and rode in it.
Yeah.
Huge mistake.
Yeah, yeah.
And, like, if it was dusty, or you remember the Nationals in our time early, they'd be hard as a rock. They'd throw a bunch of water down for the 125 mains or motos to make it to where it was decent for the 250s. So the first 10 minutes, man, you're just – it's grease. Yeah. And I was no good. Mm.
Yeah.
But I would think you would have been, like, a good mud rider. And
I had my fair share of racing in the mud. I just wasn't as comfortable outdoors, you know. I always look at guys throughout – racing, most guys lean a little bit one way or the other, mm-hmm. right? You know, a little bit like McGrath, a little bit, you know, he's good at both, but a little more supercross.
It took him a little while to get good at outdoors as well.
But
it
was harder, right?
So it was harder for
him to stay on top of that. That's why he didn't stay on it like he did supercross, because supercross came so natural to him.
Yeah.
So I feel like, you know, Carmichael is the opposite, right? He was leaning towards motocross, you know? I think guys just are a little more inclined one way or the other. You know, and a lot of guys have made the best out of both, don't get me wrong. But, you know, that was just me. I was just like, it was hard for me to get everything lined up for outdoors. And, you know, I really wanted to and expected. And, you know, I had a couple good moments, but, you know, I never won an outdoor race. You know, I got seconds.
Yeah, same. Yeah. For me, it was always when the track was perfect. There had been a little bit of rain earlier in the week. Mm-hmm. It wasn't dusty, but it wasn't muddy.
Mm-hmm.
Glen Helen in 98 when we had all that rain.
Mm-hmm.
I podiumed Binghamton 1 year when it was nice, and they groomed it between motos.
Oh, yeah. I remember they did that a little bit.
And then Steel City 1 year. Just, again, bitching conditions. Yeah. Those were my only three good rides. Every other time I was like.
That was probably more like it for me, too.
Do you think by 99, though, you know, you had spent a little bit of time on the outdoor series, you know, but you had missed some motos at some events as well. Do you think it took you a little bit to adapt to tracks? Like a supercross layout, obviously, you know, you're jumping that, doing these whoops like that. But outdoor tracks, you have to learn kind of the way lines develop and, you know, where to go outside here, inside here, you know, how to ride a little bit of the slick stuff. Do you think that you just struggled with maybe moving around a little bit more, or the adaptability to kind of outdoor tracks, or do you think it's purely just that was a setup thing?
I mean, that could have played into it for sure, but I think more than anything it was, you know, I wasn't scared to send it over a big jump. Sending the biggest jump didn't scare me as much as maybe fourth gear around a scattered out, like,
speed,
corner.
Yeah, speed.
High speed, sketchy, edge of your tires type stuff.
Yeah.
I was better because I could, supercross, I could point and shoot, you know? Mm-hmm. And people didn't round them out as much as they do now, which, you know, I mean, I think that's more what it was, just my natural comfort zone.
So keeping momentum on an outdoor track when getting across the bumps and keeping momentum up. And you might have struggled with that too, Ping, to be honest with you, because you are a really good supercross guy.
It's a very different skill set, each one.
Mm-hmm.
And I think you see it in guys' salaries when there's a guy who is really good at both.
Yeah.
It's rare, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And you see it in their salaries. They're making more because they know he's a contender for both titles.
Yeah.
And that's not always the case.
Double threat.
Mm-hmm. Double threat guy.
Mm-hmm.
So you watch guys that are really good at outdoors, and like they do stuff that I don't even think about. They're way over here and crossing over, and I'm like, man,
it looks
where's
so
he
easy.
Going? Like, how do you, the main line's right here. Well, yeah. I'm in that. Where are you going? You know, I just wasn't good at seeing it and reading it and being creative.
Yeah.
Bobby Moore, when I rode for him in '98.
Oh, Bobby Moore was badass.
Because he'd come back from Europe. He was still faster than anyone on the team. Yeah. Sheik, Sellers, myself. He'd wax us in a test session.
Wow.
And I remember riding with him, and I'd watch, and he's doing this in front of me, and he's going all over. I'm like, where? How are you even seeing this? You know, just edge of the track, and I just couldn't. I couldn't do that great.
Yeah.
Well, one thing that was fun, me and Nathan used to do, some people know this, some don't, is I think the 98-99 year when he was at PC, we always made a bet coming into the first round of the year at Glen Helen. Maybe was it 1 year we did or 2 years? Maybe only the one?
I don't know.
I really remember the one of what we did.
I really remember the one, too, and I lost.
Yeah. So the bet was, you know, we worked out in the gym together, so – you know, whoever lost at round one got to pick the other guy's outfit going into, you know, in between the weeks of training for the next race.
Oh, I think I remember this. You had a pink little top on.
Oh, yeah. I hooked him up with some, like, green tight pants. I cut one of my shift jerseys out at the nips, you know.
Oh, yeah. And I was sexy. I thought I was pretty sexy.
And I got him some of them big
slouch socks.
Nice.
And back then, you know, there wasn't as many home gyms, so we were literally at a 24-hour fitness.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was 24-hour fitness.
I think I even hooked them up with a headband. I mean,
there's a picture floating around
picture
somewhere.
But those are fun things, and for me, you know, Nathan was always, like, at that time, Nathan was getting faster than me, and practicing on outdoors, you lit it up, you know, and then we get to Glen Helen, and and me having a little more experience, you know, and ended up
for sure,
you know, being able to get them that first round usually was always mine.
Maturity and experience, he would get me on that for sure.
But it was a lot of fun doing those things. And it's kind of a throwback to, you know, Rick Johnson used to have in bets with Jeff Stanton back in the day. So we were kind of, you know, paying a little tribute to how he used to do things with Stanton.
I love it. That's fun. I mean, those work when you got two buddies and you can work and push each other. And you guys did a good
job. Ego's not there, you know, holding you back.
No, there was never any ego between me and you. No. Probably more at Loretta's than anything.
As we're both 40 whatever.
Oh, it says here you were fifth in MX that year. That's pretty dang good. That's not bad.
Yeah, but I think that my take on it, probably just remembering back, was like I wasn't a championship guy. Like, because once you are that guy, that's you don't want to be anything but that, you know?
Well, 99, we were on the same team, riding the Zooks.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Those are good bikes. We had a fun summer.
We had a fun summer. And
dude, I'm going to save this story for you, but our hotel debacle in Bampton.
Oh, God, yeah. Rob from RG3 still brings that one up.
We'll save it for yours, right, though. But so
you probably know it, too.
I can only imagine. Yeah. No, I know a lot of hotel debacles, but
this was the worst one I was ever involved in.
Yeah.
It was heavy.
I'll have to stay tuned.
It was heavy for sure.
So 2000, you rode for Mitch again?
Mm-hmm.
Did you ride the opposite coast or did you run the number one plate? I can't remember.
So right before the season started, I crashed at the test track, ended up fracturing a bone in my thumb and had to switch coast.
Okay. As I say, I don't remember you running the number one plate.
So. I didn't get to run it. I ran it at the Vegas, you know, at the shootout.
Right.
So the 1W. I ended up going East Coast and, you know, it was an okay year, but it wasn't anything. I think Ernie won. Fonseca.
Yeah.
I think he won Fonseca, that year. Yep. And I was just a little off. I just wasn't fully ready like I wanted to be. And then a couple crashes and different things like that, I think, held me back. So it wasn't – 2000 was also another, like, little bit of a letdown. I mean, like I said, everything is unless you're in the championship hunt at that point.
Yeah. So that was the year I moved in with you, right? 2000.
Was it? No. Oh, no, I think it was 2001.
Was it?
I was Yamaha of Troy when you came there.
Okay, maybe you're right.
Yeah. I don't know why I remember that, but yeah.
Well, so I was
pretty confident in the stuff that I do remember.
I was in between houses. I just always remember this. I needed a place to live, and I was coming to your house for Bible study. Amber and I, she was my – I don't even know if we were engaged yet. Well, no, we got married no one, so we would have been engaged. Mm. And I came up, and you're like, you can live with me. Just move in with me. And I was like – like we knew each other, but I wouldn't say we were tight.
Yeah.
But I thought, dude, that's really cool. Like, okay.
I don't remember the conversation, but I
it was just like that. Yeah. You're just like, you should just move in here. And Monica's like, yeah, just stay here. I mean, it was like the most
nonchalant.
Yeah. And I'm like, you don't want to think about that? Like, you guys just had Tatum was pretty young,
she
I want to say.
And no, because in that house that we were in.
That was the Elsinore house, right?
No, it was Marietta. It was Cortabella Homes. Mm-hmm. She was just learning to walk and stuff.
Like, yeah, so little.
She was like less than a year old.
Well, so after I had kids, I thought even more. Like, I can't believe they let me live with them. Like, you know, it's a hard time. I remember coming to your house one day when you guys just had Bailey in Moreno Valley, and she was screaming, and Shelly's like, "I yell at you," and you're like, "Let's get the hell out of here." I'm like, "Whoa!"
It got pretty gnarly at Buddy's house sometimes.
But anyway, and I remember I had a 65 DeVille Cadillac. It was like my pride and joy, you know.
Yes.
And I'm like, I can't leave. Where am I going to put it? I can't leave it outside. And I said, hey, Nate, if I clean your garage up, can I park my Cadillac in your garage?
There was probably this much room from the wall to the it was huge. I love that car, though, too.
I cleaned up. I'm like packing stuff in his garage. I got everything all cleaned out. And, yeah, it took up like 80% of his garage, my car. Like, that was such an ass, but anyway.
Hey, well,
I really appreciate it. I just wanted to say thank you. But I don't know if I ever said it enough to you.
I'm sure you did.
But,
yeah.
Like, I really –
I can't remember, but, yeah, I'm sure you did.
Let's just go with I did.
Yeah. Didn't you – at some point, who – I don't know if it's when you lived with me or if you did it before. Someone, like, put
– We'll get there. I got it in my notes.
Okay.
It's after the break. Okay, so 2001, you went to YOT. So two things. What happened? Why didn't you stay with Mitch? How'd you get to YOT? And then did you have a choice between 125 and 250 DF? If I remember right, you kind of wanted to be on that development side.
Yeah, so Bob Moore, we were talking, he was my agent at the time, and he was telling me, hey, the sport's going to go four strokes. Like, it's going to go four strokes. And at first, I'm like, no, no way, no way. You know, this, there's, it just didn't make sense to me, right? And then he kept saying it. And so I was, you know, my deal was up at PC, but it was on the table. And, you know, I had every intention of staying there. And then Yamaha of Troy came on the scene with this new four stroke. And so with Bob saying, like, the industry's going that way, and, you know, I started buying into it, I was like, well, I need to be on, you know, I'm older, so I need to be on the forefront of this. This could help extend my career, you know? So basically, I had to go have that talk with Mitch and Bones.
How did that go?
Which I was worried going in there, and I said it just like that. I just said, listen, like, I learned so much from you guys. It's not that I want to leave. I just think if this thing is new and it's an advantage, I want to have it, and I want to be on the forefront of all the four-stroke stuff. And they kind of both were like, almost like didn't have anything to say like to that. Like, they were like,
well, what do you
it
say?
Make, yeah. It made sense to them. I think in their minds, they're thinking he could be right. And how do we – it was almost like, I can't blame you. And then it was like, but we've never had a guy win a championship and voluntarily leave.
Yeah.
You know? And I was like, I don't want to burn any bridges. I'm just like, the only reason I'm doing this is because I believe that this bike has an advantage, and I need it. I want it.
And you were right.
Yeah.
You ended up being.
Yeah.
So did you.
You put a couple screws in Mitch, huh?
Kind of did.
Yeah. I don't know.
But nothing.
Nothing major, but enlightened him.
Yeah.
Well, you're his Dalai Lama. That was my other thing with my career was like, I rode for every manufacturer. And tons of teams without ever burning a bridge. You know, that was another thing that I didn't want to end up with.
Well, except that guy at Honda.
Yeah. Right. But beyond that, yeah. And then at the end, me and Larry Brooks got a little weird for a little while, but we were fine after that. Yeah.
So when you went to YOT, there was never discussion of the 125. It was you were going to develop that 250F.
Yep. It was me and Ernesto on the 250F. And then meanwhile, I don't know why, but Nick Way ended up switching because me and Nick were teammates at Pro Circuit, and he switched to the 125 at Yamaha of Troy. So it was me, Ernesto, on the 250Fs, and it was
– Ivan? Who was it? Who
it might have been Ivan.
What?
The other 125 guy? On the
No, it was Bucky.
Buckaloo.
Buckaloo, yeah.
Yeah, so then they were on the 125. So it was kind of – it was a weird situation because I can't imagine being a team manager or team owner and putting that together going like, okay, these are my two four-stroke guys, and here you guys are on the two-strokes, and then all year probably fighting that battle of like, well, their bikes are this. But the truth is it was gnarly. It was better in some ways, but it was also scary, and you were a guinea pig in others. So, I mean, when we started racing that thing, it still had the oil in the frame, going through the frame, circulating through the frame. So the thing was just – then they figured out how to – you know, cap that off and make it internal. Yeah.
Well, they weren't better at first, you know. Yeah. I mean, they had, like you said, some areas where torque-wise and some of the things were easier, but, you know, the 125 still had some on it, I think, for a few years after you got on it.
Well, not motor-wise. Little starting, like the risk of stalling, that at the time was like...
Yes.
I remember Ernie in Phoenix in 01 was killing it and stalled it in the whoops, and man, just...
Yeah,
he ended up finishing.
Well, there was weight, inertia of the engine. Like, it's a little bit different to adapt and get used to as well, you know?
And Ernie.
But I tell people this when I was riding factory KTM in 01, and me and Ernie in a heat race in San Diego bump in a turn, and I'm like, feet off the pegs. I go down to first just to double.
Yeah.
And he goes, and tripled. And I was right then, I went, that's it.
That's a good point, because I always say, like, the technicality to riding a two-stroke compared to a four-stroke is so different, right? Four-stroke, you could jump in first, second, third, and probably fourth gear. Because I remember doing that, like, at the supercross track, you know, no more worrying about shifting at the base of the jump. Like, if I needed to hit the jump in third, I just put it in third back there in the corner. You know what I mean? And then I remember at Atlanta one year was an on-off into a triple. I was leading main event. Pretty late in the race, and when I landed it, my foot bumped it down to first gear, and I was like, ooh, it was revved out, and I just kind of checked it, and I didn't have
time. And you did a triple in first gear.
First gear.
Wow.
I wish I could do that same triple in second, third, or fourth. So that's that's the difference, right? You say you poke a corner on a 125, you weren't getting that next rhythm.
You had a power band window of this, and if you weren't in it, you couldn't do it.
Yeah. But also, those bikes back in the day, you could be perfectly in a transition of a rhythm section, and it would cut out.
Bog.
Like it happened. A lot of things happened to Ernie more than me. Ernie had engines go like gnarly stuff go in pivotal moments. My stuff happened more practice. You know, wasn't as bad as you know. So he had some stuff go wrong.
He still won that title though, right?
Yeah,
I think he did.
Yeah, he did.
And then you didn't win the East? I thought you were.
I got second.
Who?
Pastrana. It's like 2 or 3 points difference.
But you won some races and you were up.
I had a good year. I had a good year. It was a good choice. Like you said, I think it did. Even for my style of riding, it was the right choice.
So it was more of adaptability and learning how to set the four stroke up and working out some of those bugs initially. My mindset was actually that, you know, the 125 was still pretty good, but listening to Nathan talk, it just helped me much easier. It wasn't not learning that until I actually got on one. But back then, I thought they were heavy, and there was just not as much behind it.
Well, there was a stigma. Every time I heard a four-stroke, like an XR, I mean, how are you going to race that? You know?
Yeah.
Because I'd ridden an XR 400 or 650, and you just assume that's what you're talking about.
Yeah.
Different world.
Yeah, and those things weren't that great. You know, so the 650s were probably way too fast for what you needed, and then the 400s or whatever they were.
Those were air-cooled.
Yeah, they were
lawnmowers. Yeah, I mean that was old.
The
school.
Oil was coming out the bottom.
Yeah,
they're trying to keep oil in it.
But I think the biggest thing that proved that move to be so smart was you learned four strokes. Like you said, you were the point man.
Right.
So when you went to Honda, when you went to KTM, it's like you're ahead of the curve on everybody.
So it played out. It played out really good for me. So I did that 1 year at Yamaha of Troy, debuted their 250F. Which that created an opportunity because Honda had a 450 coming out, a brand new 450. So that allowed me to catch their eye and go, hey, this guy knows the four stroke. Let's let him debut our 450. You know, Rhino had ridden it a couple of times at the end of the season at the outdoors, which was just a prototype bike. So somebody to really race it all year. So I was able, you know, got picked up by Honda. It was 2, 3, and 4, right? Mm-hmm. Picked up by Honda. Got on that four stroke, crazy, like bike was the fastest, gnarliest thing I've ever ridden. And I've raced a CR500 before. And this thing, the first bike that they sent over from Japan, this their spec, their build, like I rode it and it was so sketchy to ride because if you want to do a triple, you're going to go land on the fourth one. You know what I mean? Like and it was carbureted obviously back then. And it was just sharp. And it was like Kehoe was the manager there, you know, at the time. And I'm like, it was one of those ones. I was like, you got to ride this. So you know what I'm talking about. If you don't ride it, you're not going to understand. And so we detuned all the way until the season started. And then Anaheim won. I don't know if you guys remember that. It was like an over and under, and Carmichael clipped it going into the whoops, right? And he
up tabletop.
Yeah, Larocco hit him and crashed. So this is that track, right? So in practice, I knocked two of my teeth out in practice because I crashed all over the place because you know it was gnarly enough at the test track, but when I got to the race and excitement came up, I mean I jumped over that thing and wadded in the whoops, and I remember I got up and Albertine he had retired by then, right? He was just standing along. I don't know what he was doing out there on the track, but he was standing. There was people standing right there by the whoops, and I go, I spit one of my teeth out, and he's looking at me, and I go, can you hold that for me? And he's like.
That's how we reshaped the Hollywoods.
Yeah, that's how I got him filed into the same level. And he's like looking at me like, and I'm like, he goes like. And then I go, boom, finish practice, right?
Excuse me, good sir. Yeah, will you hold my teeth?
Yeah, it is front teeth. So one of them, I didn't catch it in my mouth. Like one of them ended up in my mouth. So two of them were gone, but he got one of them. And I was like, they're expensive. So I thought I could reuse it probably. So he I had did. To finish really that. Did. I had to finish that event with no teeth. Like, and I have I have like metal stobs that stick down, you know, that's gnarly.
Yeah.
So I'm a factory Honda rider from Tennessee with no teeth. You know,
you can't make this stuff up.
Oh, it's really so funny. That is the funniest thing I've ever heard. so how did that? I mean, obviously that season you got your win at Pontiac, which take us up to that point though. Like, how was it going throughout that season? Were you guys, did you keep detuning it?
Yep.
Was that
yep.
thing bogging on you? Was it pretty?
That thing was more clean and it, you know, didn't bog hardly at all. It was just really, really fast. So we're detuning, you know, trying to get it to a point where I felt like I could ride it harder. Cause I always just felt like, especially on supercross, I was just like, whoop, whoop.
Yeah. Well,
but I had some good moments. I mean, let's see, Houston was before that, I think. I got second there. You know, I had some podiums along the way. Some pretty solid rides. Like, that was the one where Ricky cut track and he passed me and they didn't say nothing. I'm just kidding. It's true. I didn't know it at the time, but it was a weird, like, elevated section, and it was like a three tier, and he cut under the hay bale when he passed me for the lead.
Really?
I didn't even know it. No one said anything. I didn't realize it for a long time, actually. So I try to give him a hard time about that when I can. But I got second, and then I think I got third. I had several podiums, and then that Pontiac race. So back
that was a wild race, too. If no one has ever seen Pontiac 02.
Oh, yeah. It's a must-watch.
Yeah, go find it on YouTube, because it was like the race nobody wanted to win.
Yeah.
But it made it so fun to watch.
Right. Yeah. So the funny thing is, just backing up to that during that week, the Japanese would come out and test with us, and they'd come up with ideas or whatever. They had came out a couple weeks before that, and we were doing testing, and they had all kinds of crazy stuff for me to try, which was always – it was cool going from Pro Circuit, who tested every detail of everything, good, bad, whatever, and then you're at Honda, who had access to so many different cool parts. Was just really neat, right? And I was into that. I liked testing, and I had pretty good feel most of the time for it. And I was sitting there, you know, we've been detuning the bike, you know, I was just like, things so fast. And I'm like, I remember I was telling one of the Japanese technicians, I was like, it's so fast. Like, when you know how you start talking like that.
Oh, too fast.
Yeah. So I'm like, when I'm in corner and it's choppy, I can't stay on the bike, you know. And I used to make fun of Bundy for doing that all the time, but I'd catch myself doing it. But so I'm like, you know, I need street bike seat. I was like, you know, street bike passenger. And I was like, so I could stay in place. And they were like, oh, okay. It was a joke, right? I was just joking, right? And I'm just like, I can't hold on to this thing, basically, and especially in the chop, right? So next week, a seat shows up.
With the step.
He invented the hump, too.
Made the hump.
People don't believe me when I tell them this. I didn't make the hump, but it was an extension of the step.
I know. I remember that seat.
Right?
Every great idea starts somewhere.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and went to Pontiac. First time I rode the hump seat during the week, and I was like, it kind of works. Like, it was a joke, but it's kind of good.
Was it lowered in the pocket?
No.
Or it was raised in the
back?
It
was raised. Oh. So there was a little downside to that, you know. So it was just normal height, and then it was only like that. You know, it wasn't very high, but it was raised all the way through.
Yeah. Had a buddy like it, riding on back down to the gate and all that.
Oh, he loved it.
He could see over his head.
Yeah, he's like, we have foot pegs, passenger pegs. So anyway, went there, Pontiac, by the way, crashed in the heat race, had to go to the last chance qualifier, came out of last chance qualifier, the last guy to the gate.
Is that right? I don't remember that.
Yeah. And then through that crazy race, whatever, first race with the hump seat or the street bike seat or whatever you want to call it at the time, and ended up winning after, what was there, eight leaders or something?
I can't. That's where Ricky looped out and... Yeah, an amazing ride by him too. Yep. It was just a really fun race to watch, and I can't remember all the leaders. Who was in that thing?
I remember
everyone. You were sitting there like sixth at one time, and then it all shuffled.
Ferry,
I believe.
Yeah. Anyway, go watch it. It's a million people.
Basically, imagine, and most people probably have seen where he loops out off. It's a dragon back onto flat, right? Yeah. Just onto a straightaway, and he loops out, and it was almost like we were all, you know, behind him. And we all were like looking at each other with our eyes like this big. Yeah.
Who's gonna win?
We got a chance now. Yeah. That's exactly what it felt like. Yeah. Everybody's like, go, you know. Yeah. And it was like from Lust to Villeman to McGrath to Tortelli to Ernesto. Yeah. We all led it. Me, there was
Ferry in it.
Ferry,
him up there. Yeah,
Ferry was up there. Ferry and Lust had a pretty good hold on it. Like, they were probably gonna, and they both kind of whoops. There was kind of a technical set of whoops that were pretty long and parked on the tough block. I fell in the race too. I grabbed the tough block and messed up McGrath at one point. He was behind me. I
you know, front brake the tough block and fell over, and he ran into me. Yeah. So it was just
It was chaos.
Yeah. And, you know, like I mentioned earlier before the show, one of the probably the coolest moments was, well, first of all, with all those different leaders and all the craziness, and then I could hear the crowd, and, you know, Carmichael was coming. You know, that I knew that, you know, like.
Your eyes are starting to go like this.
Crowd, yeah, I'm starting to kind of go down like this again. The crowd's going crazy. No. So the crowd's like making me think Ricky's like right on me, right? Yeah. And I'm just like, holy crap, if he comes back and beats me, and I'm just like, hit the white flag, and I was still in the lead, and I was like, there is no way I'm letting anybody pass me now. This is not happening, right? So I was
Who was behind you? I mean, he got to second, right?
Yeah. But
was he close? I can't remember.
He ended up being like second and a half, 2 seconds, maybe three bike lengths.
Too close for comfort.
Yeah. But it felt closer the way the crowd was everything was going. And Jeremy got third. So at some point, there was a little bit of a gap. He came through, got Jeremy, and then he was working on catching up to me, but ran out of time.
Maybe people don't know, too. Like, when the crowd gets loud, I mean, it's loud.
Yeah.
You hear it like, oh, and they're yelling about something.
Your mind starts playing tricks on you, too. You start going, he's right on me. Like, you almost start to see their front wheel, you know, or whatever. Yeah. So it wasn't until I went back and watched the race to realize, like, oh, I still had a little bit of room. I didn't have to cut every turn and block, you know.
You're hugging inside.
I was, like, inside to inside, like, just trying to just protect the lead, you know. But then went over the finish line, you know, awesome feeling, fireworks go off, and then I pull over onto the next jump and stop, and I'm just like celebrating, and you know, Carmichael pulls on one side and McGrath pulls on the other side, and they literally both are just like, I really think they were genuinely happy for me.
Yeah.
At least like they pulled it off if they weren't, but
do you have a picture of that?
I don't have a picture of that, but they both hugged me and they both gave me five, and they're like, yeah, Nate dog. And it was just a moment that I really like held on to. And I never got a picture or anything from that, but then obviously that night, podium shots, right? And didn't even dawn on me at the time, but later some good friends of mine, a guy named Miguel Guerrero, that was a family friend, he sent me the picture probably that next week, and he's like, take a look at this picture, and it's me in the middle of the two best dudes, and I'm just like, that's a cool picture.
That's a framer.
Yeah.
A framer.
Yeah. So that was definitely a special moment. You know, like we said, it's my only big bike win, but it was really cool.
It was a great one.
Well, did the street bike seat stay on for the rest of the season?
That's a good question. So it started getting a little sketchy, especially like different tracks. Like if it bucked me too much in the whoops, and I kind of, this is before you really locked in and got improved my technique there, Buzz. I was too far back and it would blow my feet off a little bit. So I kind of like, once we got the bike where I liked it, I went away from it. Uh-huh. And then some other people started putting just the bump on there,
not the full hump.
Yeah. So I ended up going away from it, and I don't know how soon, but I ran it for a while. For sure,
that's interesting. Good story. I love the way that that came to be. That's hilarious. And you're on the record books, man. Like, there's just so few people that win 450 Supercrosses.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
Think of all the great riders who just didn't get it done.
Yeah. I mean, probably a lot of guys better than me on a motorcycle. You know what I mean?
Well, not according to the record.
Well, I just know, like, I see kids, you know, I tell some kids that I work with now, I'm just like, you're so much better than I was at this point. Like, you have no idea what you're capable of, you know, and they find it hard to believe. But I always, like I said, viewed myself, I wasn't that talented. It was more driven, right?
Yeah.
Heart and driven, and, you know, the record books that, I mean, you know, you never think of it that way, but Ezra Lusk actually pointed that one out to me, because he was another good friend of mine who I also learned a lot from, him and his dad, Ronnie Lusk.
Oh, Ronnie.
He came up to me and said, dude, you're on a short list, like, of a guy that has won one of those races. And I was like, I thought it was cool that he took the time to say that, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, it's, you know, at the end of the day, when we look back on our racing career, you want to have all those injuries, all the scars we have, you want it to be for something, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, you probably put some money away, and that's great, but, like, you want there to be, I don't know, you have left a mark, right, somehow.
Yeah.
And really, the record books, one of the only ways
Yeah.
That doesn't ever go away. You're in there forever, man. Like, that's that's rat.
That's true.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Very true.
Anyway, hey, we're going to take a quick break. This is your TLD timeout. Stay tuned. We're going to be right back to finish up with Nate Dogg.
Dunlop. There is a reason every AMA championship in the past decade was won on Dunlop tires. They are the best. Choose the best performing tire and brand that has never wavered in their support of our sport. Choose Dunlop. Pro Circuit. Pro Circuit products are designed with one goal in mind, winning. Through passion and hard work, Pro Circuit has operated the most successful 250 team in the history of the sport. They use that same formula when developing exhaust, engine, and suspension parts for every brand. But only the highest level of performance is acceptable. Trust Pro Circuit.
Since 2009, Seat Concepts has been dedicated to making the best aftermarket seats. More comfort, more grip, more riding. For 10 years, we've continued to raise the bar. Innovation and American craftsmanship make Seat Concepts the world-leading manufacturer of power sports seats.
At Nihilo Concepts, we have a passion for innovation and for motocross. Our mission is to develop parts that will improve the durability, functionality, and the appearance of your motorcycle. We're proud to say that everything from Nihilo is made in the USA in our state-of-the-art manufacturing facility in Stuart, Florida. Whether you race every weekend or you just ride for fun, Nihilo offers high-quality, innovative parts that you just won't find anywhere else. Nihilo offers custom engraved engine covers, one-piece titanium foot pegs, brake tips, internal engine components, specialty tools, frame grip tape, carbon fiber components, and so much more. Check out our website, NihiloConcepts.com, and see for yourself why teams like Red Bull KTM, Rockstar Husqvarna, Troy Lee Designs, and some of the fastest riders in the world choose Nihilo Concepts. NihiloConcepts.com.
Specialized Bicycles. Specialized leads the way in the world of bicycling. Whether it's cross-country racing, downhill, e-bikes, enduro, road, gravel, dual slalom, dirt jumping, or all mountain bikes that do it all. Specialized has the perfect ride for you. The brand is synonymous with engineering excellence and innovation that steers the industry. Visit your local Specialized dealer for a test ride and see just how good Specialized products are. OGIO Power Sports. OGIO has perfected the carrying case, motocross gear bags, helmet bags, boot bags, hydration packs, backpacks, and travel bags, to name a few, have all been meticulously engineered to maximize space and surpass durability standards that would make NASA proud. Simply the best. OGIO Power Sports.
Mesh intercom on.
Follow me.
Yeah, I'm going behind you.
All right, let's all hit it real close together. The Senna system is such an advantage. You turn them on and you can talk to each other. It just changes the whole game to communicate real time instead of saying, oh, come in, hey, that corner there.
They're like right there, you know?
It's definitely better than the old set.
It's like you want to keep it a secret because it's such an advantage. It's going to help us.
With a rich history in motocross, ProX has been dedicated to supplying quality components since 1975. Whether you're rebuilding an engine or just need a new chain, ProX Racing Parts aims to bridge the gap between OE quality and affordability. ProX has over 9,000 part numbers and over 60 different product types that are manufactured by highly reputable or even OEM suppliers and are offered at affordable prices to help keep riders on the bike instead of in the garage. Visit ProX.com to search parts for your bike or check them out at your favorite online or local dealer.
Established in 1853, Motul has grown to become a recognized leader in lubricant technology. Riders from around the world trust Motul to deliver the endurance and performance needed to compete at the highest level. Currently the official oil and lubricant partner of the Chaparral FXR Honda team, as well as the AJE Motul Gas Gas Racing. Ricky Brabeck piloted his Honda HRC using Motul products, become the first ever American to win the Dakar Rally in 2021. With a complete product line for your motorcycle, ATV, UTV, side-by-side, street bike, and automobile, Motul continues to push new technology developments, utilizing our patented Ester Core technology to offer the best balance of performance and protection. Continue to power your passion with Motul oils and lubricants, found at a power sports dealer near you. If you have Little Rippers, you have had to have seen Stay Sick Bikes by now. We have created bikes and experiences that allow kids to develop sooner and empower them to define their own ride. From learning to ride to sharpening skills, the Stay Sick promise is accelerated growth. Whatever path your family chooses, it's going to be the ride of your life. Stay Sick Stability Cycles.
Hey, I'm on vacation every single day because I love my occupation. Hey, I'm on vacation. If you don't like your life, then you should go and change it. I'm on vacation.
And welcome back. That was your Troy Lee Designs timeout. And be sure to get over to troyleedesigns.com, look at everything they've got going on. The full 2021 line of gear is out, including all their mountain bike protective gear, helmets. They've got a the paint department is still cranking, so if you want to get lettering, numbers, or a full custom paint job, they are ready to go. Just give those guys a buzz. We're stoked to have their support and proud to be a TLD guy here for a long, long time. So check those guys out. Support them for supporting the show. Nate, getting back to your story here, I want to bring back to the what I refer to as the great TP incident of 2003.
We're starting out the next half like this, huh?
Yes, well, just like this. So I don't. Okay, so I went out with a buddy of ours, a guy named David Huff, and my wife.
Oh yeah.
And I don't know what the deal was. Oh, you remember Huff? He came to our Bible study.
Well, he was
our neighbor. He lived next door to you. Yeah,
he was our neighbor.
Well, that was the other guy. It was the three of us.
Yeah.
And maybe that's why. Because I'm thinking, why did we go TP Nathan's house? But maybe that's why, because we all knew you.
Yeah.
So anyway, we were out, and I think we might have had a couple drinks. I can't remember how it all got started, but we went to this four-way stop that's not too far from your house, and he was telling us about this thing. You go to a four-way stop sign, and you take duct tape, and you lay it down on the white line, and then you put, like, some pennies on it, and then a car rolls up, and it gets sucked to their tires, and gets sucked up under the car, and goes, click, 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 you know, and we thought that'd be funny. So we went and did that, right, and someone does it, and they're getting out and yelling, and we're laughing, you know, hiding in the bushes. And then we're like, let's go TP somebody's house. And then your name came up, and it was like, yeah, let's go to Nathan's house and TP his house. And so right down the road from your house, there's some construction going on.
Oh, my gosh.
That had the little triangle signs or, you know, whatever the hell you call them. They got, like, a blinking light on them.
Yeah.
So we get a handful of those, cones, like anything we can grab from this construction site, right? And I don't know how many rolls of toilet paper we have. We go to his house, and the whole front yard, dude, signs blinking, cones. I duct taped his front door together so he couldn't open it.
I couldn't even get out in the morning.
TV'd the whole house, and then we never said a word for a long time.
I don't think I knew forever. But it looked like a construction zone, like, threw up on my yard. Like, and the duct tape on the front door was good, too. Yeah. And then you said, I still didn't know, and I got all the stuff on the side of my house. I don't know why I just didn't throw it away or take it back to the dump. But I was thinking, who did this? And I couldn't figure out who did it. And then
he had it in evidence room.
These are pretty nice blinking, flashing light signs. So, you got me
so
good.
He puts them on the side of his house, and he said he'd be laying in bed at night, and this yellow light.
Still haunting him.
Oh, yeah. Man. So anyway,
dirty.
I apologize. It seemed funny at the time.
How long did it take you to figure out who it was?
We've talked many times about getting you back too, and I don't know why we never did. Like, how did I let that go?
I don't know.
I don't know
just
either.
Brought it back to the memory.
Yeah,
you definitely
still could happen.
Definitely owe me.
How long did it take you to figure it out?
I don't know. It was. I want to. I'd say it was like years.
It was years. It was a long time.
And I didn't figure it out. I think you must have just told me, or somebody
I think
did.
We did.
You couldn't handle it anymore.
Or maybe Huff told me, or I don't know.
Didn't you tell me somebody went to get out the door, and you guys were like, couldn't get out. You were like stuck in the house. You're like, what's going on?
Yeah, it was weird. Weird feeling when you're stuck in your own house. Yeah. And then I'm like running around.
Today they call that a smart house.
Oh,
so good. All right, moving on. Let's start with 04. 03 was that your first year with Honda. You got that win. Going into 04, take us through that year.
So 02 was Honda first win.
And oh, yeah, that's right. Sorry, I mixed it up.
No
03 was the great TP incident.
Yeah. And 03, just to touch on that one, going into the season, actually broke my femur. Yeah. My buddy.
Oh.
My friend, buddy, was there. And
test track? Or
he panicked
was
a little bit. La Paglia's supercross track there in Marietta. West Marietta.
It was not good. Right when he went down, he knew instantly his femur was broke. And I'm just like looking at his leg, like, I'm like, really? And he's like, yep, it's broke. And
right away.
Yeah. I've done it. Yeah. So that was the end of 02 going into 03. Like, we were working together. Like, things were good. Like, you know, 02 went pretty well. And then everything was good. And it was funny.
Yeah, you were jamming too. Yeah,
I don't know if you remember, but it was just a small set of whoops, and we had worked the jump line through them.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I did it a few times, and I was like, "Man, that's better than blitzing them. That's going to be good. Let's see how it does on the lap time." And I hopped in, and the thing caught an edge and got out, and I was ready for it to like high side, so I was kind of like off this way, and it went like this. And when it did, my foot was still on the peg, and my knee was on the ground, and it just popped it way high. But I was on all fours on the ground after. I was just like this, like a dog. And I'm like, my buddy comes over, and I can't turn over. I broke my femur.
So you're putting all the weight on one leg or
something? Yeah. It was my left. So I was on all fours, but I couldn't turn over because I tried to roll over, but my leg wouldn't, it would stay there, you know, like because it was broken.
Ugh.
So it would stay there. So every time I try to roll over, it wouldn't go with me, so I couldn't. It would, and it hurt, you know. And Budman comes over there, and he was like, kind of, frazzled.
Yeah, I was real frazzled.
And then, actually, on the other side of the hill was Brent, the dentist, who was our dentist guy for everyone, and he was close by, so he came over, and he actually grabbed my leg, and like as I turned to my back, he moved my leg, and yeah, that one I remember laying there going, okay, couple months, I'll be good, and I mean, 4 months later, I started riding again. And then, like, literally pretty quick, because the outdoor season started or was starting, I needed to race, you know. I couldn't even – if I started to fall over on a left-hander, I couldn't even stop myself from falling over.
Just because the leg was weak?
Leg was weak and just wasn't, you know. I mean, the bone was safe. It wasn't going to break again, you know, without something major. But ultimately, I didn't get back to ground zero for a year.
Mm-hmm. I remember seeing you somewhere, and you had a radical limp. It was way after.
It was like the muscle wasn't firing correctly, so I walk like my hip would go like this, and I couldn't stop it. And I went to all kinds of therapies and like, you know, nerve function stuff to see what was going on. And I mean, I was riding; like, it was easier to ride than it was to walk. Mm. You know, so that one was a rough year. Just started off wrong. You know?
Yeah, yep. And a year had so much promise with how he was riding beforehand, and you know, just working on some small details that you might need to use in a race, and something like it happens. And for me, like just seeing your buddy in that much pain and
it's tough.
Yeah, it was really hard.
Yeah, yeah. And
did somebody call 911 eventually? And
well, I think you probably. I don't know if it was you. One of the two of you did, and they were out there pretty quick and literally because the way. We all were probably with Dr. Ryman. It was like, hey, Nathan broke his femur, met me at the hospital. This one I went to the hospital and basically went straight into surgery.
Yeah.
Fixed it up. So that year, all the work that we had done to kind of clean things up more, like when I come back and you come back from an injury and you're not completely healed, you have to like sacrifice some technique and some positioning. And so I developed a lot more bad habits again.
Mm.
So then it took us, you know, kind of struggled through that year. I can't even remember if I had any highlights from that year. I can't remember any.
Yeah, I have tough summer in my notes. So.
Very true. Very true. I'll
had a limp.
I'll agree with that. I mean, nothing changed but my limp.
That's not an easy injury to come back from it goes perfectly. So.
Right. Yeah. And I thought, like, oh, a couple months, like I said, and it just turned out to be a bigger deal. And, you know, I know some people have came back in a couple months. It just all depends on the break and where it's at. So,
well, obviously, and how the muscles are firing, and there's some other details that can happen with it.
Yeah. Yeah.
One little detail I will say is that I never thought about this when I was racing at all either, but, like, if any mechanics, trainers, anybody that's going out there with a rider, know the address to where you're at, where you're riding.
Yeah.
Right? Because all those test tracks, those aren't like listed addresses. And when you call 911 and say, there's a guy, I need somebody out here, any medics here.
Yeah.
All right, what's your address? I mean, what are you going to tell them? Yeah. When Christian Craig got hurt, broke his back at the Honda test track the day I was there, I said, just tell the engine to get off at, what's the exit there? Temescal Canyon.
Yeah.
I'm going to meet him at the 15 and I brought them in because I'm like, I don't even know the address.
Yeah.
And there's not, I don't even know that there is an address, right?
So I think now you can maybe
drop a pin or something.
I don't know if you can do that with them. You might know more, but
I don't know with dispatch. I'd have to ask, but I'm just saying, think about that stuff.
Well, it's weird out with mine and Nate's work a little bit in USMCA and us going through CPR and some of the other training we've done. You know, I didn't know anything when Nate hurt his femur. Like, I was just another rider too and had no clue of what to do. And that was probably like the worst feeling for myself, that I didn't know how to even roll him over. It took, you know, Dr. Brent to come down and help. And so, you know, now with the work we've done there and going through some of that, you do realize some of these things that you need to be aware of surrounding-wise to be able to help somebody if they do go down, you know. Yeah.
And a lot of it is if, I mean, the advice I give people, stabilize their neck and their head. If they have any kind of neck or back pain, don't let them move. Call 911 and just try to keep them calm. Like, if you can just do those things. Talk them through, like, slow breathing, like, just, you know, breathe through the pain or whatever the hell's going on. But, like, those things alone until medics can get there
make a huge difference
because it's so easy for people to spin up because you want to help, but you don't know what to do. You don't have anything.
Yeah.
I mean, it's...
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway, little rabbit hole. Moving on. So 03 sucked. Yep. Going into 04, were you, at that point, healthy, looking good?
Right. So my contract with Honda was 2002, 2003, and 2004. Mm-hmm. You know, so obviously I missed quite a bit in 03. It wasn't a great year. You know, going into my final year that was on the contract, I can't remember what month, but Chuck Miller gave me a phone call, and he was like, hey, I got an idea. I want to see what you think about it. And he was like, you know, I know that you were the guy who debuted the Yamaha 250F, then you went on to debut our 450. We have a brand new 250F coming out next year. And I never pointed out. So he was like, at this point, he was like, I think you'd be the perfect guy to debut it. And he was like, I don't want you to think of it as we're taking you a step back. It's just a big deal for us, and we think you're the right guy for it. So, of course, I was like, yeah, absolutely. So in 2004.
So it was indoor and out?
Yes.
Okay.
So in 2004, I actually, you know, took that step back to the 250, the lights class. And that was the year that me and Tedesco went at it pretty good. And I ended up second, I think, in that one too. I've been second like three other times.
Yeah, but one thing you did really good with that 250 program is set that up for Short to kind of have a platform for him to kind of launch his deal into as well.
Yeah.
Were you reluctant to take that at all? Like, did you ever go, oh man, I don't really want to do this? Or
not really.
Okay.
At that time, I didn't realize how intense the 250 class, I forgot that it was so intense, because the 450 class is intense, but it's a different, there's a little respect, there's a little bit, and I was a little bit older, you know, than I was the last time I rode it, you know, so I was a little shocked at that, but at the time, I was just like, look, I was stoked, I thought it was a good idea, maybe rekindle the fire a little bit after such a bad season, and, you know, I just wanted Honda to be happy with me, because I was planning on doing something when I was done racing with them, you know.
Yeah,
that was the idea, like let's stick this thing out, you'll have some career options after you're done. So yeah, debuted that 250F and battled, had some good wins on it, some good podiums. It also had a cutout thing that was very scary. I actually, that year I jumped front and high most of the time.
As a precaution?
Because when it cut out, then I was on the right pitch for the downside. And no
thing,
offense.
If
it
was bogs just, on me, I grease yeah, it. Front yeah. wheel down.
If it didn't, I was just rocket air. But, you know, the bike was awesome in a lot of ways, but that was the scary part of it, was that little bog. So kind of got through that year, it was solid. It was good enough. And, again, that backing up to that decision to go on the four-stroke, got me the first Honda deal, next Honda deal. Then all of a sudden, I didn't plan on leaving Honda, like I said, but I get a call from KTM. And
he's a debut guy.
You are the debut guy.
Hey, we got a 250F coming out. We'd like for you to be one of the guys that goes on it. We think you could help us develop it. You know, and so at first I was like, nah, you know, that's where people go to end their career. Even though I knew I was on the latter part of mine, I was kind of like, I don't know. And so I was kind of bouncing back and forth with what I should do. And then they kind of upped the deal. And then I think at that point, Red Bull came in even stronger. And the bonuses were crazy.
Really?
Crazy. Higher than the 450 bonuses are right now.
Like, what basically. Were you getting for a win? Can you say? Ballpark.
Well, for a heat race, you know, typically it was like, most heat race wins would be $1,000 bucks. I was getting $5,000 for a heat race win. And then let's just say if a 450 win these days is anywhere from 70 to 80 for one night, it was
more than that. Mm-hmm.
I don't know if it would matter.
How many did you win that year?
It was $100,000.
How many did you win that year?
He buckled.
Yeah. He gave into the frame. We got it.
Yeah.
You get ice cream.
It's crazy though. Like,
you won some races that year too, right?
Yeah.
You won five
or six races that year. And the championship bonus, trust me, I was ready to break my neck to get that thing. And I finished second. second in the series.
Which is great. I mean,
yeah. Tedesco. No, wait. Who got me that year? That was Honda was Tedesco. Could have been him again, actually.
Was GL?
Yeah. Yep. Grant was around at that point. But check this out. Yes, it was Grant, I think. That was also the year, so first year on the KTM, Phoenix Supercross. I had won the opener's mutter. I won the opening round. Get it to Phoenix. Everybody's feeling good, pumped. It was probably two or three laps into the race, and there was a triple along the right side, and then I think it was a little roller double coming in, and then it was one of those where you do a 90 and you roll double and go across the start line sideways. Mm-hmm. And I moved into third, and I had this little cool little line where I would stand, and it was just a little bit quicker instead of seat bouncing, right? And double and go across. And I just moved into third, and again, it was pretty early in the race, feeling pretty good about it. And right when I roll and double, I land on a tough block. And, you know, your thought is like, okay, do I gas it or do I try to just roll out of this thing? Well, I was like, I'm gassing it. I gas it.
Of course.
The thing spit and I crashed, right? So then I get to my bike, crank, 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 crank. No electric start yet. The leaders came around like twice before I got going again. So that was a heartbreaker. And then to put salt in my wound, and I didn't know this for a couple of years. I think someone was talking to me about it, and they were like, oh man, I remember when you kicked your bike at Phoenix for two laps. It was, dude, that was tough. And I was like, yeah, I just jumped a little too close to the edge, landed on the tough blocks. They're like, nah, not really. And I was like, what are you talking about? And they were like, well, earlier in that lap before that, somebody had clipped them, and the track workers went and grabbed them to put them back. And when they put them back in further the inside. Line where you were landing. So I went to the same spot.
It wasn't a mistake. It was just
So that got me later, because that could have been a championship. And like I said, it was big money, because it kind of brought that story back to light last weekend when Jet jumped. You know, when it was that same style section, and he went. It was the Tuesday race, right?
Yeah.
And he jumped a little too far off, and he clipped those things. The same type of thing. He crashed a lot harder than I did, though. Yeah. I think, but. made me think of that. But that
hay bales just blew apart back in my early days.
But they, you know, because people were making the argument, oh, we need to go back to hay bales. But I'm like, I've landed on hay bales.
They're not any better now.
Yeah, they're dirty. They don't budge.
Yeah.
But I do feel like someone was, I don't know if it was a mock-up, but it was like a hollow one. So that if you landed on it, it just collapsed.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So it was kind of like a cardboard box almost.
Yeah, I've actually seen those for different events.
Maybe run them in Europe maybe or something. Like the bottom is weighted so it doesn't tip, and then it's hollow, you know, just.
Yeah, it's almost like a box.
Yeah.
Basically, but it looks nice. And we've used them for our brands and different like kickoff events.
Oh, is that right?
Like that. They're pretty cool. But I mean, literally wind can blow them, you know, like it just depends. You could probably get close enough and just, you know, blow it off.
But if the bottom was weighted, like make it out of heavy rubber or something, that way it wouldn't move, but the top would collapse if you landed on it.
Yeah.
How about if they just take them off the backside of landings?
Yeah, that's another
one. I didn't see that heavy or that tough block there again the rest of the night.
I know they moved
it. No, they moved it.
The idea was to keep, they thought, well, it'll keep people from getting into the mechanics.
Right.
So I get the concept, but man.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah.
All right. So how did you end up that year overall? Second, you said.
Yes. Yep. And I'm pretty sure it was Langston who got me on that one. And that one.
That sounds right to me.
Yeah. Yep.
05. He was on PC, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So.
And how'd the summer go? Moments. Summer go okay?
Man, there wasn't a whole lot of highlights with my outdoor career. So that one seems to fade off into the distance.
Tough summer.
Yeah. A lot of tough summers.
Yeah.
You know, I can't even think, like, what was my best race of that year on outdoors, to be honest.
Was there any hiccups with the development of that bike? How did it go compared to the Honda?
So that's a good question. It was actually very, very fast bike. Mm-hmm. So really good engine, strong engine, little heavier feel, but never cut out ever.
Mm.
And it was still carbureted at that point. And that was the one thing. I mean, I could triple onto a table, and before I was always ready for it to cut out, you know. This just awesome.
Was Haney your teammate that year?
Yeah.
Okay, that's right. He damn near won the East Coast region, if I remember right.
Yep. He.
Well, that can't be right because he raced GL for that
he
championship.
He did. So
in
GL was on that one. It was Tedesco. It was Tedesco.
Okay.
Because it would have been the next year that Haney.
Yeah, 04 and 05 he won.
Yeah.
You're right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
So 06 KTM again?
Yes.
Yep. Mm-hmm. And how'd that season go?
Same thing. I mean,
good.
Plenty of good stuff in Supercross.
Yeah.
Tough summer.
Tough summer.
I honestly don't remember, so it couldn't have been that good, but I do know this one, and this one's kind of funny or cool. Final race of the season. You know, I was finishing up my KTM deal. I had already signed a deal with San Manuel Yamaha for 2007 and 8, Supercross only.
Yeah.
All those tough summers.
Yeah.
I was like, hey, that sounds like a great deal to me. So I jumped all over that. And I was older.
Yeah,
so I was
later,
like,
yeah.
I was like, you know what? This could add a couple. I could squeeze a couple more years.
And it does. You know, when I went to Arena Cross only contract and I stopped doing the summers, it definitely, like, you had this break, you know, and you had enough years under your belt, as you know, that you knew what to do. You knew how to prepare yourself so you could take that good break. And then you're like really like
fired up, ready
to go.
It was pretty good. Best case scenario. Really, you know, so basically backing up to that final race, Glen Helen Pro National, last race of the year. And I was like, I never have been a fan of Glen Helen. It's just got the best of me too many times.
You knew there was going to be an outfit afterwards.
Right. No, I don't think so. Should have been. That would have been nice.
But I wasn't doing outdoors anymore by then.
So first moto of Glen Helen, and I'm in this race going, I'm Supercross only. This is my last outdoor
national
pro national. Yeah. I'm done with nationals. I'm like, so that was my motivation for that day. Like, I'm gonna go all in, all out. This is it. I'm done. And I got 11th in the first moto, and I was like, you know, whatever. It's my last national. Who cares?
That can happen real easy,
right? And so then the next moto, I got a pretty good start, and I ended up battling up front and end up fourth in the moto. And I get off the track and they're waving at me, the podium crew, oh, a podium, podium. And I'm like, no, 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 no. I got 11th in the first moto. And they're like, and I keep going. And they're like chasing me down like, Nate, stop. You got third place. And I was like, no, it's not me. I got 11th in the first moto. And they're like, get to the podium. And I'm like, okay, pull over there. Sure enough, 11-4 for third overall.
Come on, no way. Really?
Yeah.
Was that the Alessi incident race?
No, it wouldn't have been that one. Where Matt Walker, no, that where he stood on his
that
bike.
That was 5:05. Yeah. Okay.
I don't remember. Well, I don't know what got it so jumbled up. But
Nathan don't care what incident it was. It was just podium.
Yeah.
That's great.
That's all I remember.
It's weird. Tough summer, my ass. 11-4 for a third.
I finished my motocross career with a podium.
I love it.
It was 11-4, but that's okay. Boom, went into my supercross only, San Manuel, which was an awesome, awesome opportunity too. That was cool.
And so you hadn't ridden Yamahas before. Was that the turnaround motor, or was that still the old? That was still the old one.
Yeah. But I did ride Yamahas with the 4-stroke.
Why? Oh, that's right.
Yamaha of Troy. So I had already ridden Yamahas at that point, but not the 450. Okay. And it was still pretty aggressive. It was still carbureted. The bike was pretty gnarly, right?
I remember Reed even saying he had bog issues, you know.
He actually did have a little bit more issues with it than me on that Yamaha. And especially the 2007 model was, and then 08 was a little bit better. So anyways, got this opportunity to do Supercross only with San Manuel, which was first time some weird sponsor like that had ever been, or some different, I should say, different sponsor had ever been involved. And it was biggest sponsor our industry had seen.
Mm-hmm.
So, and the craziest thing was we had to say San Manuel Band of Mission Indians Yamaha. That's how we thanked them.
It's a mouthful.
So it was a mouthful. But you did get used to it, but it was so weird because at first I was like, that's weird because they had the casino and the bingo, but they weren't pushing that. They didn't want us to say anything about a casino, anything about the bingo. It was all about their mission. They were a band of mission Indians, and their mission was outreach in their community and giving money back and doing things for people. And like, they had a lot of really cool things that I learned along the way that I had a lot of respect for what they were doing with the money that they were making, you know, and they were investing it back in their community. Yeah. We went to schools for, you know, underprivileged. We did a lot of cool stuff. So that was a really neat sponsor. Obviously it was me and Chad Reed, which we were neighbors, for a long time at that point. And you know, it's just a cool couple of years. I actually, in 2007 of that one, I prepping for Daytona Supercross, was at Chad's house in Florida and ended up crashing and breaking both my arms.
That one
was a tough one. Yeah. I literally,
Monica, get up in there and wipe for you.
She had to. It's not a proud moment.
I've been there.
It's not.
I've been there.
Yeah. So I flew home.
The best was the plane ride.
Flew home. One thing. I was also cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs because I got a concussion too. So I'm like, I didn't want to get surgery there, so I wanted to get back to Dr. Ryman and those guys and let them do it. So I'm like, basically Larry and Chad and everybody kind of got me all ready, and I think I left out that next morning early and jammed me on a plane. Larry takes me and checks my bags in. I'm 2 slings like this, just arms just wrapped up, right? Not even set yet. Not even set in place. And my Vicodin painkillers were, he's all, I'll tuck them in right here. And then Monica had booked a first class ticket just so it was a little bit more comfortable, right? But I had a layover in Atlanta.
Oh.
So I'm on the plane and I'm like trying to get my Vicodin out, right? And the guy sitting next to me is like kind of watching me, like probably, you know, feeling sorry for me. He's like, hey, you want me to help you with that? And then I'm like, yeah, please. And then he did, got it. And then I was like, I gotta go to the bathroom. Like,
Can't
ask this fool to help me to go to the bathroom, you know? So anyways, I worked it out, but I did. I was like literally in Atlanta airport with like this on my layover, like a zombie walking around. Like I couldn't sit down, just too uncomfortable, just walking around.
Man, like, that had to be miserable.
It was horrible. And landed San
Diego.
How
did you pee? Hold on.
He goes, I got that handle.
Yeah.
How do you stewardess. Get your zipper down?
Well, I had a really nice stewardess, and she was very helpful. No.
This thing isn't going to shake itself. You want to give me a hand?
I took one of my arms out of the sling and, like, made it happen.
Was so, one worse than the other?
Yeah, well, so this one was just broken. And it was actually a bigger break, but it was less painful and easier to heal.
Okay.
This one was broken, and then the lunate bone displaced. In the middle was like, it tore everything out of there. So it was the one that was still displaced. This one was just kind of, you know, wrapped
fractured.
Up.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
It was a break. It was all the way through. So
that was the one. That was a zipper hand.
It was a little, it was legit. But landed in San Diego. Monica picked me up. She actually, like, brought me food because they had scheduled my surgery for the next day. So she brought me food. I hadn't eaten. So she's, like, feeding me food, right? And I'm just like this, feeding me food. And then on the way home, at that point, Dr. Ryman had gotten the x-rays and everything that he needed to look at. And he's like, it's still displaced. He's like, you can't leave it like that. You may lose the feeling and mobility in your hand. Like, we have to do surgery now. You have to come straight in. Ooh. And I'm like, I just ate. Like, you know, you're never supposed to eat. And it was like, okay, well, all those times I didn't eat. They're just like, if you throw up, we'll take care of it, you know?
Yeah.
Like, so I had to go straight into surgery. It's a pretty long one. And that one actually obviously took me out of the rest of that year. And I thought that at that point I was done, because it was right. Like this whole part of my hand right here was all numb. Mm. So my clutch hand was numb. I couldn't feel. And Dr. Ryman kept telling me, hey, it'll come back. It'll come back. I got faith. I think you're going to be good. It'll come back. And then sure enough, it did. And it moved. It was the weirdest thing. So the numbness went all the way. It went out all the way until the very tips of my fingers were still numb, and that was it. And then it was done. And it was good.
Wow.
So
it doesn't get numb when you ride or anything? No? Yeah.
No. I mean, this arm, like grip strength and everything, is still a little bit not as good. But, yeah. I mean, my body's been through a lot, and I feel pretty good for 46 years old, you know?
Yeah.
So I almost retired at that point. Like, I had the Lloyds of London. I had all that stuff I could have cashed in, and I was tempted. I had another year on my San Manuel contract and ended up going, you know what? I think I don't want to be done this way. I don't want to be done because of this. And And I got the feeling back. So I was like, all right, let's go. So I raced 2008. You know, I mean, I'm getting older, but still pretty good. I mean, the last race that I did for San Manuel team was the race. I think it was St. Louis. It was the race before the final, like, round in Vegas, I believe. It was something like that. It was like the race before
close
the final
to the
round.
End. Yeah.
Yeah. And I ended up getting fourth. I take the back. It was two races till the end. I got fourth at that race, which was awesome for me at the time. Like, pumped. I don't remember if Chad won or not, but it was good for our team. Then the next race was Seattle. And Seattle, heat race of that night, Dusty Klatt. Do you remember him?
I did. Yeah, Canadian kid.
Yep. Yep. Well, I mean, we were buried in the pack. We both got a bad start. And there was this, like, table two off-camber left-hander. And no one was jumping it, and I didn't jump it, but he did. And he landed on my arm, so you see that divot?
Jeez.
So he landed on my arm, and right away, like, just blew a hole in my arm like this, and Bogner and all them come around. They're like, oh, it's compound fracture. They wrapped it, right? And all the time I'm going, I don't think it's broken. Anyways, long story short, it wasn't broken. It was just a hole in my muscle right here. Just
foot peg or something.
Literally,
grab it.
Yeah. Yeah, it was the bottom of his foot peg. So it didn't, you know, it just blew it open. So missed Vegas
the
next round.
That's a pretty big divot. Yeah. It looks like someone hit a tee off there with a 7-iron.
Shark bite.
Yeah.
And obviously I missed that final round, and that was that kind of transition where that was my last year of that contract, but I was planning on staying with the team again. Like, when I was done racing, I was going to be with the team, work with the team. It was a great place to be. And it didn't work out. Kind of didn't work out in the ninth inning or ninth hour, however you say that.
11th hour.
Yeah, 11th hour.
Easy, Ricky.
Yeah, yeah. Tell the tape.
You know, I'm trying to tell the tape here. But, I didn't have many options. By the time I found out, look, I'm not going to be on that team for, at that point, would have been 2009. I mean, the options that were out there and the offers that I was getting, I was like, I don't think it's worth it. I think I got to call it quits. So I was cool with it. I was like, all right, you're done. I started working with actually Blake Baggett. Mm-hmm. I had coached and done some, you know, schools and different things along the way, all the way up. But he was the first guy that I actually really Did supplemental training and on, you know, off the bike, on the bike, everything.
Was that when he was, what was he on at that point?
He was Cowie. He was Team Green
Mitch?
Guy. No.
Oh, not Mitch
he
yet.
Was, he was okay. One of the, it was him and Dean Wilson coming up, and it was like, who's going to get the pro circuit ride?
That's right.
Right? And so I got James Coy and actually Brian Fleck from Dunlop approached me and like, hey, have you ever thought about working with somebody? And I was like, well, yeah. And he was like, we got a guy for you. And I didn't even know who he was because I didn't follow the amateur scene at all.
Yeah.
So basically, they set it up. I met Blake and his mom, and it had been raining, so we hit the hills mm-hmm. out behind his house in Grand Terrace, which was Ritchie Canyon. Mm-hmm. We went to this track that I'm sure we rode at some point.
Absolutely.
Pretty cool track. And I, dude, like less than 5 minutes watching this kid, I was like, oh.
That's what's coming.
He is for real. Like, this kid is legit. Like, I told his parents, I'm like, I'm in. I'm all in. Let's do this, you know? And so he ended up, like, going, you know, that whole year I was with him and went to Loretta's. And it was him and Dino kind of battled it out. Dino, I think, ended up winning the championship. But Blake was coming from behind the whole time. Kind of a story of his – some of his career. And like he was, and I remember telling Mitch, but I understood like the process. Like I think Dean, you know, he did the job, got the championship done, so he deserved to be there. But I told Mitch, Blake's gonna do something, you know. And he ended up, not to go down that rabbit hole, but Blake then ended up going on to the
Rockstar, right?
Yeah, the Rockstar Suzuki team at the time. Which I was still with him. But so in the meantime, I'm thinking, all right, I'm retired, I'm done with it, I'm gonna continue to ride a little bit. I think I did some supercross in Germany that was on the books. It was a pretty cool deal. And then I get a call from J-Bone at JGR, and it was Cody Cooper had gotten hurt, and it was a couple races into the supercross. And so he asked me, hey, would you want to fill in and do the rest of the supercross series? And I was like, you know, that thought was in my head, like, when I'm done, I'm done. I'm not going to be that guy who comes back. But I was like, but I didn't really choose to be done yet.
You know, he justified it.
Well, I mean, actually, J-Bone is the one. Because I was on the phone with him, and I was super nervous about making that decision. Because I, you know, again, I just didn't – I felt like I had milked my career for what it was worth, and I didn't want to keep trying to do that. You know,
J-Bone can be pretty persuasive. And for me at the time, I was coaching just kind of, I think, my second year into really amateur coaching, and – he's getting with Bag, and I'm like, I knew how things were, and I knew it was a great space for him. So he's just getting going, Blake. Then all of a sudden, you're going back racing. I'm like, what are you doing? Yeah. Like,
oh, you were telling him, don't do it.
I just was like, you know,
yeah,
you're invested in this. Like, I don't know. I just was at a different space than him. Obviously, it was his decision, but you know, I was just like,
yeah,
you got something here. Keep going with Blake. You know,
yeah.
Which I ultimately ended up still staying with Blake, still working with him. I just had to figure it out. Like,
well, how long had it been since you've been riding and training? Like, did you ever think, like, man, or were you still riding pretty consistently?
Well, you were riding with Blake quite a bit in the beginning, right? Like, through that process a little bit?
Not really.
No?
I didn't even have a bike for a while. I rode a little bit before I went to Germany because I had some Kawasaki deal that I rode over in Germany. And so I did a little bit of supercross stuff training at that point. And that was another one that I was like, I just want to bail out of this. But it was pretty good money. So anyways, I'm on the phone with J-Bone. And he's like, look, because he could tell. I'm like, I was kind of like, I don't know, man. I should be done. He's like, just come. Ride the bike. He goes, you decide you don't want to do it, you don't have to do it. And I was like, that's pretty simple.
That sounds like a good deal. No harm. No harm.
Yeah. So I'm like, it literally happened quick because I was going
to probably Texas.
It was North Carolina, but it was like, it was probably Saturday or it was probably Sunday.
Yeah, but it was right before I think Whitney and all that was happening amateur wise. I think at the time.
Yeah, I don't remember that. I just know the Supercross was New Orleans, and I only had that week, and I hadn't been like this was beyond the time when I was prepping for Germany, but
Germany's in like December, right?
I was fit, you know, my fitness was good, but I hadn't been riding.
Yeah,
so I was like, oh boy. So when he said that, I was like, okay, that's cool. And then I got on the plane to go there, and I sit down, and this girl's sitting beside me, and she keeps looking at me, and I was kind of like, hey, do I know you or whatever? And she's like, are you Nathan? And I was like, yeah. And she's all, I went to school with Monica, so she was her name was Stacy Coleman. Anyway, she went to school with Monica, and she's sitting by me on the plane. She was neighbors with Joe Gibbs growing up. So I'm sitting there on the plane doubting this, what I'm doing, and then I end up sitting by someone that is very close to the Joe Gibbs family, and I tell her what I'm doing. She was going somewhere else, like different, like total random. So then I'm thinking God's kind of showing me something, like maybe this is your last little hurrah. You can go out on your own terms. So I went there. I rode 3 days. Felt pretty good. So I went to New Orleans.
How did that bike stack up to?
It was good.
Was it good?
It was good. It was cleaned up a little bit. Like the power delivery, everything was much more controllable. I think all in all, like I was very impressed with that whole team and everything they did and got me going for that weekend. And it was just like J-Bone's like, hey, just make the main. That's all I want you to do. Like, and I'm like, I don't know how many laps I got in me, but made the main. Through last chance qualifier, and my hands were like blood red. They were just so sore by the time
nothing
I got to
you
the
can
main.
Do, but you got to put the time in for that. Yeah. Right.
So I was very fortunate to have that a team of that level and to be able to go like, all right, I'm gonna do this. I get to ride all the way through Vegas. I think like I ended up eighth at Vegas.
Yeah, pretty good. Yeah, pretty impressive. Bike from the start beginning,
knowing my final race, and I did, you know. I was excited about eighth place at that point, you know. So I got to
kind of call it on your terms.
Yeah. So it felt good. That part of it felt really good. But I did continue to work with Blake.
Yeah. You know, I mean, just going back to MySpace, like I'm just a big believer is like if you call it quits, like you're saying, and you go back, bad happens. Like, you know, it could have been, but I get going out on your own terms because you don't want to have any resentment, you know, or anything that hangs you up because it's just gonna play with you later. So I think at the end of the day, you know, it was a good move for you, you know, mentally. I was just nervous for my friend.
Yeah. No, and I appreciate that. And I always, you know, took what you had to say and to heart. But I think once I kind of got on the plane and got there and then I felt pretty good on the bike, it was just like, okay, this is, I'm going to be okay, you know? Yeah. So I got to go through that and then ended up working with Blake through some of his first year stuff. He won his first supercross, you know, like he won Dallas. And then from that point, that's when the Reinenbergs from Australia came over. And this guy, he actually talked to me on the phone and said, hey, I'm going to start a team in the U.S., you know, and I've your names came up. I want to talk to you about managing it. And at that point, I never managed a team or. You know, the only thing I knew about managers was the interaction between the rider and the manager. And I just kind of blew it off. Like, okay, you're going to start a team over here. And he was kind of had these big plans. Anyways, long story, he did everything he said, put it together, boom. All of a sudden, I'm team manager, and we did, you know, that's the JDR, J-Star, KTM team, which we had, you know, Ty Simmons and PJ Larson's the first year. We kind of splashed on the scene pretty good. You know, had a really good crew chief, a guy named Vince Barini. And we put together a great crew. Renee was there.
Yeah, Renee's awesome.
You know, we had some good guys on there. We had some good momentum. And the parents were behind us huge. You know, not the parents, but I say the family. The family was behind us, and they were investing a lot of money to make it right. And it was like a 10-year goal, and then recalibrate from there, you know. And everything was moving forward good. So we did, you know, 2010, or actually 2011, 12, and 13. And in 2013, so by that time we had kind of moved through a couple riders. My riders were, I had finally got to go out and get some guys, you know, that were guys who I selected. So I went to Loretta's. I had picked Malcolm the year before, Malcolm Stewart. I went to Loretta's. I watched Joey Savacci, and I was like, you know what? I think this guy can do something. He was in kind of a weird place with his not knowing where he was going, but he was a real guy. So we grabbed him. So I had, you know, Malcolm and Joey as far as the main guys on the team, and then Josh Kasia would come over and do some racing from Australia. But I think it was three or four races into the Supercross season in 2013. They pulled me in the office. His dad was in town, Jay and his dad. They pulled me in the office and said, hey, we got some bad news. You know, we got some tough news for you. You know, we need to shut the team down. And I was like, oh, man, I thought, you know, like, my first reaction was like, okay, well, you mean, like, at the end of the year, you know, like, well, you know, I thought we were going to go for 10 years. And they were like, no, we need to shut it down today. So basically they had the money they were funding it with was from a hedge fund, and some things happened with that. It got turned upside down. So they couldn't put their own personal money into it anymore. And that money was tied up until things got figured out. So I basically talked them into, I'm like, well, at least like, let's at least get through the Supercross. Let me warn the guys, let them start looking for jobs. Like, let me do this, this, and this. Let's get through Supercross. So they said, okay, we'll make that happen. So that was pretty cool. So I was able, I mean, that same day, pulled everybody in the office, told them what the status was. This is where we're at. We're going to finish Supercross.
That's a hard conversation.
I had to call Big James Stewart. Like, you know, think about the people I had to talk to about all this. You know, it was tough. So anyways, did that. Then a guy came in and acted like he was going to buy everything. So got everybody's hopes up. And then I even talked some people into staying that already had offers, right? So here I go again because I wanted it to be so bad.
Yeah.
And so that was probably one of the toughest things that I've been through, you know, because I, you know, we all poured ourselves into that team and it was so close to being like completely where we wanted it and being not profitable, but breaking even to where it all made sense. And I think we were probably 6 months away from that, and it just all fell through. And it was
you get very emotionally invested because you put so much into it. Everybody,
Mean, it is. No one will understand unless they've done it. But you absolutely 24/7 pour yourself into that, and to have it kind of just pulled out from under you like that, it's just devastating. And so I was done. I was like, I'm out of this industry. Yeah. I'm done with this industry. Yeah. I got my sales license. I was hitting the auction with my buddy Jared that owns J-Star Motors. Basically, I didn't want to have anything to do with the industry. And then my friend Buddy here talks me into doing – what did we do? A couple schools, right?
We did a couple schools. We did a little race. And then I basically also – you know, had a couple kids that maybe I thought Nate could learn from Nathan, and I said, hey, work with these guys, and he just, you know, I knew it was something that he could excel at, and I knew he would enjoy it, you know, because some of the thing you probably dealt with at the JDR team and all that is the responsibility of everybody else, right? And so, finally, when you're doing some coaching, you have the responsibility of coaching the kid and develop him and the parents and all that, but you're really working for yourself, you know, so I knew he would enjoy, you know, that part of it and watching him grow and learn, and some things that you did with the kids that he worked with was just, you know, awesome. And I always know that when I see Nathan's kids out there that he's worked with, that Nathan's had his hand on them just by some of their demeanor and the way they carry themselves, the way they do things. So that's just something that he does really well. And so from there, it just kind of snowballed for you with then talking with Christy and working with some Orange Brigade kids from there, and he blossomed in that field
like a flower, just fully opened up.
It was pretty neat. I got sucked right back into the industry, and you know, it was what I know, what I love. It wasn't hard to suck me back in there, but it was fun. We had a great time working together, and we actually continued to over the years too, because I came in first off at KTM. Christy LeCurl was like, hey, I'm the manager, but she's like, you know, now that Sleater has moved into a different division, she's like, I'm kind of missing that guy who can talk about lines and talk to the kids. And she's like, I want to bring you in as a coach, like a team coach. And I did like a camp, and then ended up after the camp, I went to Loretta's and kind of was around starting to get to know the kids. And then that role it became a little bit heavier as the year, like I think it was 3 years, 2 or 3 years at that. So if it was,
13 to 16.
As like coach, and it evolved into like performance manager. So I started dealing with the sponsors and doing more, but it was the performance of the team, not necessarily being the manager. Mm-hmm. And then Christy ended up end of 2017.
After she made us race at Loretta's.
Yeah, right after that, she ended up leaving. And so it was a natural thing for me to kind of slide up into the management role of Orange Brigade. And then that kind of has kind of evolved, you know, just amateur race manager of amateur racing at this point.
So you enjoy that? I mean, it's something, seems like
I do.
You know, I've done some camps and schools and worked with kids, and there is something really satisfying about
a kid that'll listen, mm-hmm. and you see them making something in their technique, and you talk to them about it, you work on it, and they fix it, and you see that improvement, you're like, wow,
yeah.
What I'm telling you, it works.
Bang.
It is. There's something about it, and how hard the kids work and the families, how much they have invested, and when they know you have that you have their best interests at heart, and you're only trying to help, and me and Buddy are a lot alike. I learned a lot of my coaching styles and things from him, but we're not force feeding this stuff. I'm not telling you they have to do it. There's core values that you mm-hmm. need to be doing, but there's certain guys that are going to do things different. And I think we're grown up enough to understand that, hey, you don't have to sit down. Everybody doesn't have to sit down at the same spot going into a corner or whatever, whatever it might be. We work with them instead of like shoving it down their throats and I think that's ultimately kind of goes a long way with the parents. It does.
And one thing, Nathan, going back to his coaching ability, I know he's still coaching kids, but also doing more. When he came in 13 and started coaching, I had been doing it for a little bit, but then me and him started vibing off each other. We'd talk on the phone sometimes for an hour about, let's try this, let's try that. What do you think about this? You know what I mean? Mm. And it kind of helped, I think, mold a little bit what we do with these kids. Because there is, I think you've found and I've found, there's a procedure. Certain things you can do to create these steps and almost drills or techniques that help them learn and evolve. And then it kind of grows from there to, like Nathan was saying, like this kid doesn't sit down there. He's sit down there. He's more of a stand-up rider versus mm-hmm. sit-down rider. But that's been a lot of fun and a lot of the creative side that him and I have been able to vibe off with each other. Nathan coming into the role that he's into now, overseeing everything, I mean, it's just with his demeanor and where he's at, it's just such a great fit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it seems like it. I mean, you guys both, I've sent a lot of people to you when they say, hey, who would be a good coach? I mean, both of you two are the first guys that come to mind for me.
Thank you.
Locally here, I know your programs is solid. What did you think of the team manager role, and as a, what was the hardest thing for you to
the pro
to
team
learn?
Manager?
Yeah,
okay. I know you've been down that road too.
That's why I asked, because like the first time I had it, they're like, all right, just throw a budget together on an Excel spreadsheet for me and bring it up. Bob Weber's telling me, and I'm
not
like,
not the way it goes.
Dude, my eyes were like this. I'm like, oh,
start
God.
Sweating.
Excel. I get on there and I'm like, I punch something in and this moves. I'm like, oh no. I had no idea, dude.
So I was pretty lucky on that side of things, right? I didn't have to get into the budget stuff until more when I was at KTM, but because the family that was behind the JDR team was more like, just they wouldn't let me work a budget. They'd be like, just let me know when you need money. So I'm like calling Australia, hey, I need $100,000 in the account, by Wednesday. It's weird. It's a weird phone call, right? And then, next thing I know, boom, money pops in. It got sketchy sometimes, because then sometimes it wouldn't go through, and there'd be people's paychecks. And so I was managing all that, but I didn't lay out a budget. I wanted to get into that, but I was the same as you. I was like, kind of like,
carry the one.
I'm going to write it down on a piece of paper. It's a screenshot. I think, like I mentioned earlier, it was like, what I knew about a team manager was the interaction between the rider mm-hmm. and the team manager. Mm-hmm. So I thought, I'm like, because my whole career, I was like, oh, cool, I'd love to be a team manager when I get done. But I didn't know what all they did, So then it's like, even going into my first year, I didn't know all the things to worry about from like, the semi being getting ready, how much extra parts and how much, like I said, I had a good crew chief that helped a lot with that. But like, from, all the credentials to, all the plane flights and hotels and, I was doing all that too, like, because I didn't have a secretary or wasn't anything like that. So I was doing that. And then, like you said, like making sense of what kind of money you're spending and why you're spending it and selling it to the owners of the team. And then the organization of it,
It's very different when you're on that side of the table, right? Like as a racer, you're like, just pay me some more money. Yeah. Like, what's the problem? And then when you're on this side, you're like, okay, I only have this and I've got to pay that and that, and that, and that, and that, and this. And your salaries alone take up 70% of your budget, and you're like, I got to go racing on this. Like, oh my gosh.
I think the big part is, and maybe the same way for me, it was like, you as a rider, you put in this work, you show up, you race, you go, we leave, right? As racers. and then we want more money, right? But on the other side of it, you got Nate when he's in the manager's role and all these guys that are in it now, which they're doing 100-hour weeks, mm-hmm. you know?
Your phone doesn't stop ringing.
You know, you're kind of in there, and there's not 2 days of rest. There's maybe a day and a half, if that sometimes, you know.
Yeah, the time commitment is very gnarly, and just you have to be all in to get it done. Yeah. You have to be one of those guys that's all in. I don't know any manager that can get the job done, and they're like, you know,
working 8 to 5.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Right. Yeah. I'm out of here. It's 5 o'clock. I'll see you guys tomorrow. There's just so many things to get done. You know.
Yeah.
I enjoyed it, but it was much more in depth than I ever imagined.
It always is, coming from the rider to the other side of the table.
Well, you just have one thing to worry about when you're the rider. Just,
yeah, exactly. Just me. Exactly. And you think as a rider, I got a lot to get done today.
I got to go get that massage at 3 o'clock.
What time is my massage?
We're getting sushi at 6, right?
It's cheat day.
Oh, man, I got a lot to do.
It's cheat day. Who got the ice cream?
Best and worst race bikes you had your whole career?
Ooh. Man, that's tough. So, worst race bike, I mean, there's little things about them, you know what I mean? So, it's hard to really categorize it. I mean, are you talking about once I was factory?
No.
I can go back.
What was your
well, that's easy. You get my worst one. I had a Yamaha. I was on 125s riding for a shop. It was whatever year, because there was only 1 year I was on a Yamaha as a privateer. And I forget who did the motor. But it was so slow, and like we were at my aunt's house before an Atlantic Supercross, and I was just telling Bundy how slow this bike was, and he was like, "What, man? What?" And then I rode it up and down the neighborhood, and then we put a stock cylinder on it, and it was like night and day.
Better,
yeah. So I was like, so horrible suspension, horrible engine package, and then ended up stock going to race Supercross. On 125, a stock 125.
Perfect.
So that's my worst one. I'd say my best one, probably for sure my Honda 450, like technology wise, was probably overall the best.
Like your last year there?
Yeah, once we kind of got through.
03, I guess.
The hump seat and stuff. And
it's a street bike seat.
But yeah, truthfully, the JGR bike, when finishing up on that, I think I could have done the most with that in a moment if I was who I was a couple years ago or whatever, you know. So that was capability-wise, I think that one was good.
What about teammates? Best and worst. Did you ever have a bad teammate where you're like, dude, this guy.
Dude. No, but I mean,
Come on, Nate.
You obviously got guys that, you know, you don't vibe with as much. I got along great with all my teammates, pretty much all of them, but I'll tell you a little story. But I'd say probably the one I was with the most and the one that I enjoyed the most was probably Nick Way, because he was on my team a lot. Yeah. We were on the same team, and we still, you know, his kid now is one of my amateur riders. Yeah. So it's the same thing. It's just fun. I mean, but some of the funniest things, and probably the guy, I was fine with him, but Casey Lytle, we were on Pro Circuit. It was me, Carmichael, Lytle, and Nick, right? And it was so funny because we'd all be up there getting dressed, and me and Nick are just having a good time. We might be rapping or whatever, but Ricky used to mess with Casey, not Lytle. I'm Casey Johnson.
Casey Johnson.
Sorry, wrong Casey. With Casey Johnson, he could get him so fired up just by just messing with him. We're just getting dressed, and they'd just be going at each other, and Ricky would always say, FLZ, baby, whenever you feel ready, FLZ. And it would be like, at the first, we were like, what? In his frog landing zone, if you feel froggy, come on, bring it on. And he wasn't mad at all. But Casey Johnson was getting mad. And he would get to the point where he would tell Mitch, I can't sit with him and sign autographs. I can't sit with him and sign autographs.
Is that right?
Oh, he had this chip on his shoulder, and Ricky used to just dig on him. Dig on him. So
that is great.
He wasn't my worst teammate, but it was kind of the funniest, kind of most awkward situation.
Yeah, that's great.
It's
a good story. What about riding? I'm always surprised when guys who retire don't really, they just stop riding. I don't see you ride hardly anymore. You either really.
No,
Do you miss it, or are you just like, nah, I'm good. I rode enough. I'm done.
You know what? For me, maybe Nathan, you experience this too. Like I barely rode until I, you know, once I got it. When I got done, I was done, just like you were saying. And I'd taken all these risks, and I rode a few times, but it really wasn't where I wanted to be. And the few times I did, I hadn't ridden so long, you're just, like, frustrated. So you just decide to just go away from it. So then at 17, when we came back and we started riding and training, like, I was feeling really good. And then afterwards, I rode for a good period into 18. Then for me, when I moved back to North Carolina, there was just no time to ride. So right. then it's like you get away from it, and it's just, you know, the feeling's gone. And so it takes so much to get back that feeling for me that – and it's just like, I'd just rather stay away.
So I do miss it. And when I do it, I'm always like, oh my gosh, it actually makes me feel younger and makes me feel more connected and all this good stuff. Like, but then again, like what Bud said is the longer I'm away, the more I know, like, I don't want to go out with the kids I'm working with. They're about to work me. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I need like some secret sessions.
Yeah. Give me, going to the hills.
Give me a month of going to the track on my own so I can at least be somewhat do what I'm taught, practice what I'm preaching, right?
Yeah.
Too. So I can be competitive with the guys. But in 17, we did ride enough to where that became better and I could even challenge the guys some, you know?
Yeah,
but,
yeah, me as well.
But we're not saying go out and race with your guys though, but like you go back to why you started riding, you know?
Right, just, and I do love it, but I need some time by myself.
And maybe Nathan, you experience this, but with the kids that we coach, like, because of how we coach them and what we tell them, like, we better be on our game, and to be honest with you, because they're just going to be like, you're not doing that. You're not doing that.
Oh, yes.
Put some pressure on.
They point it out.
Yeah,
they will point it out.
So, like, going through the hills and,
you're
probably all good with that, too.
Yeah. I mean, even that, like, now it's been so long. It's been over a year since I rode. And it's not because I don't want to or I don't like it. Also, for me to take the bike and go and do a day when I'm working with kids, it makes my day so much longer. I got to get back to the office. I don't really have time to go back, wash the bike, prep it up, get it ready. Like, it ends up sitting in my garage dirty for 2 months, you know? And so it's the process of everything. Yeah. But if we always have said, like, let's ride once a week or twice a month. Like, let's just make it happen. And then time goes by. Yeah. And then the more time goes by, the harder it is to reel it back in for me.
Yeah. It is almost like a curse of working in this industry. You work here because you love it, but then it's so time consuming. You don't have time to actually go enjoy it.
Yeah, no, true.
It happens all the time, you know.
Yeah, but people make it happen. I mean, John Hines, who's probably one of the busiest men I know.
He was at Kauai yesterday.
He goes riding
or not?
He makes it happen. He makes it happen. So we're not making it happen.
Yeah,
you know, speak for myself, but I'm not making it happen. And I'm just, you know, it's because I would want to be able to do it on a certain level, not like the way I used to be. And I don't want to go out and race with any of the good guys or anything like that these days. But I want to be on a certain level to where I would enjoy it. And it's going to take me a little while to get there. And I don't have the time for that little while.
Yeah.
Does that make sense? Yeah.
So, and I'm lucky with the Vital MX job because I get to test bikes. I probably ride twice a month. But it's just enough to where. Right.
Yeah, it's probably.
I see you out there. You look good. You
look
fine.
Take a few laps. I'm at 80%, man. I'm not turning any heads, but it's like you get the flow down and you're like, it's just so fun. Yeah. Like, I just still really enjoy it.
Yeah.
And so I always think, like, Factory, too, the same thing. He doesn't ride anymore. Yeah. I'm like, man, come on. I give you a bike to use. Let's go. And he's like, you know.
Because I guarantee it's because it's been so long, he knows, like, you know, you kind of got a little.
Yeah.
Status, a little name to live up to, you know, like you used to be a guy.
Well, you got to swallow your pride. Trust me. I go out there and there's kids going, phew, phew, and I don't even know the names. I'm like, never heard of him. Yeah. Nope, never heard of him. There's a kid on an 85.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I know.
So,
yeah.
There might even be kids on 80s passing.
Shut up, bud. Hey, I want to give a quick shout out to your wife because when you guys first got together, I'm just going to be perfectly honest. I thought, I don't know, maybe I kind of thought like Mitch, like, is this chick just like around Nathan because he's successful? She was very loud. I remember she'd run down to the podium and she, you know, she'd really soak it in with you. And I thought, is she just like doing that, you know? I always liked Monica. She's great. She's a one-woman party. But I just, in the back of my head, I wondered if she'd take off or something when you were done. You know, cynical, like, but you've seen it happen plenty of times, right? And when you quit racing, you made good money. She could have just cruised, and she went back to school, got her nursing license, and she's kicking ass. And I was like, I don't mean to sound condescending, but like, I was so proud of her for like supporting you 1,000% and then going, okay, now it's my turn. I want to go do what I'm going to do, you know, and you turn around and do that for her. I just think that's like,
well, that's cool.
It's like, rare and it's very cool.
Yeah. I mean, I appreciate you, your honesty and saying that. And I mean, obviously I never felt that way. Like, you know what I mean? I knew.
Yeah. Well, I don't know the intimate stuff, right? I'm just seeing it from the outside.
Right. Exactly. So I was never worried about that. And I know how much of a hardworking family she comes from. Mm. And I also know that when we got started, she was already career oriented and she's working two jobs. And then she basically was going to school to be a teacher. And she paused all that. Like when we got going and I realistically, when I met her, I was already rolling, but when I met her and we kind of hit it off and got serious, my career also got better and everything worked together. So it was like, cool. You know, she kind of put her career on pause to support me through mine.
Yeah.
And then through that, she kind of along the way realized, you know, I don't know if I have the patience to be a teacher like I thought I wanted to be. Through injuries, she took care of me like, and saw a bunch of it and learned, you know, little things here and there and decided, you know what, I think I'd like to be a nurse. So she always planned as soon as I was done, she was going to go back to school and become a nurse. And it was really, really hard on her.
That's not easy.
That late at that age to become a nurse. Because she's, even at the hospital where she works, she's like one of the oldest ones. Like they don't usually realize that until she tells them because she looks so young. But, I mean, she's very ambitious. She's a go-getter. She is a get-stuff-done girl. So I get what you're saying because she was also, like, run down, cameras on. She wasn't doing it for the camera, but she's very
She just had like that much hype.
She was very, passionate and energetic and excited for you. But as a guy looking in, you don't know if that's genuine or...
Right. Well, right? I mean,
because we've all seen the girl who's down there, like, you know, looking into the camera. And
yeah, well, she got caught looking in the camera a couple times. Like, she's hugging me, and she's like, looks up in the camera, like, well.
So you get caught looking at your muscles, she gets caught looking at the camera.
We're two of the same.
No wonder. Those muscles look good, man.
He was pulling a shirt up at one point, and he's getting ready for a muscle check.
Just a little roll up here like this.
Drinking that haterade.
It's all love, brother.
What's next for you? What's the future hold? What do you see yourself doing?
Well, I mean, I'm very happy doing what I'm doing. You know, I love the connection. I really like the KTM group and the company. They're fun to work with. You know, I've known all the people there for a long time. It's comfortable. Mm-hmm. You know, they give me a lot of free rein, which is nice. You know, and it seems things seem to be growing for me there as far as responsibility. Not that I necessarily want tons of responsibility, but, you know, I think the confidence goes both ways, you know. The confidence that they have for me is growing. So opportunities come up. And to be honest, like, you know, I'm happy with what I'm doing. And I think there's a little hybrid part of it, extension that I have in mind that could work out at some point in the near future. But I don't necessarily have any aspirations to climb back up into the big time pro management. You know, like I'm not looking for Ian's job or Roger or, you know, to bump, you know, when those guys are gone, do I want to go back there and do that? You know, at least at this point, I don't, you know.
Yeah. Well, going back on the road for however many rounds a year, I mean, is that something you'd?
Well, you got to think. I mean, my kids now are 18 and 20. That's crazy. Yeah, I know. You were there when my first one wasn't even 1 year old. No wonder I don't remember all this stuff. So, you know, we get to a point where, you know, they get functioning in their life. Like, and my wife, Monica, you know, she's worked at the Alpine Star Medical Unit a bunch of times over the years. We could, you know, I could do that. She could go a lot. It could be kind of cool.
That's like, true, yeah.
I mean, not that she's going to make a bunch of money, but that just keep us to be able to travel together at an older age. And I could do that.
A different too.
Could do that. But I'm also older and I like being home, you know, I enjoy it. Like, so I don't really see myself, never say never, but I don't see myself jumping that heavy into it. But even as what I'm doing now, I mean, I travel quite a bit. And then, you know, when you're gone for amateur stuff, it's a week or two weeks at a time. So it probably adds up to almost the same amount of travel days. It's just sometimes it's clumped into shorter deals. And then when the future stuff was going, then I was starting to do that a little bit more. And you know, so there's that stuff. And then, you know, what I'm doing with Max Miller and Josh Varese, two of the Orange Brigade kids this year, is a little bit of a hybrid deal where they actually went and raced the supercrosses, but they still got to do some amateur stuff for me, mm-hmm. right? So there's that that's kind of coming into play because I'm trying to still figure out how to – what's the best way to transition a, you know, a young up and coming rider into this, you know, average age of 26 lights class. You
yeah.
Know? Yeah. 24, 25, 26, whatever. It's old.
It's changing, right? Like I think the ages of everybody is kind of bumped up a bit.
It is. I mean, if you take a couple, you take Jet Lawrence or Max Volan out of there, you know, like, it goes even, right. they're pulling it down a little bit because right. they are young, you know? So it's really tough to come in, even as a superstar or an elite guy, I should say, and be successful right away. The trend yeah. is 2 to 3 years.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's too bad when teams don't see that, you know, because I've heard Mitch say that. Like, it's a 3-year process to get a guy to win, really.
Yeah. And I don't even think it's about seeing it. It's about the demand, you know, because a race team and a team manager has just the same pressure that a rider has on them. You know, that's something we didn't touch on when we were talking about the management position. You need to perform.
Yeah.
So, I mean, if someone says they're on board with, oh, it's going to be 3 years, let's hire this guy for 3 years, and then we're going to make, I think we'll get a championship on the fourth year. It's hard to keep them on board.
Yeah, yeah. For that long.
Yeah. So, yeah, then it makes it tough, right? Like, you got to go, okay, I need a guy who can win. Maybe a good backup for him. I got podium guy, and then a kid that I can develop that in 3 years will be this guy.
Yeah,
right. I mean, in a perfect world.
Timing, yeah.
And trying to get that right. to work out, like, good luck.
I can't tell you how many times I said this. You know, I spent a lot of time. I'm in the same office with TK, and we're always talking, you know, fixing everything. But and like I'm like, in a perfect world, this would line up with this, and this guy would move in when he moves in there. That means with no injuries and nothing going wrong.
They got a Ponzi scheme going
like,
on.
We're like this, and then we're like, man, when does that happen? Yeah. And like, all right, well, this is the template that we would like, or the tentative schedule that I'd like to see. But it's still hard because you still, you know, you take somebody as good as, you know, Deegan, who looks like he's got every bit of promise in the world, and you just don't know what happens when they go through puberty and things change and motivation changes and, you know, your what's important changes. And, you know, and I'm not saying that at all about him, but it's possible. It could yeah, it could go possible. Wrong. For it looks like it shouldn't go wrong. It could.
Stroop, yeah. Izzy, go on and on. Those kids had the talent to be
yeah.
multi-time champions, right? Yeah. And yeah. Yep. Injuries, you just never know.
Never know.
This is this sport, there's no guarantee.
Never know, and that's why I'll go back to, and I know you agree with this, Nate, is they're still young. Give them their breaks. Let them blossom. Don't overwork them, and if they're bound to be successful and ready to put in the work when the time's there, they'll do it.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's just hard to get through that down period if they can't stay with a team, or let's say they don't even get a team. You know, they don't even get one of those rides at first. It's hard to get through that lull of development.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I'm trying to go, like, how do we do that, you know? Like,
yeah.
I mean, there's all kinds of ideas floating around there. Obviously, the obvious one is to have that futures class or even have a class where you could run it for a couple of years before you even get to the main 250 lights class, you know?
Mm-hmm. I still don't know. But, I mean, that I think it's a great idea with experience, but it's still going to take, and you may be able to say something against it, but it's still going to take that kid's mental state to be able to put it together and put together a series and do things correct, you know, because, you know, travel is a big part of what these guys got to deal with, mm-hmm. You know, and just, you know, coming at amateur, not racing every weekend, you know, and racing every weekend and getting your body back and, you know, recovered and going. And so, you know, I think there needs to start being conversations that help these kids, you know, be more comfortable earlier for sure. Because like you said, who wants to wait? Mm-hmm. No, not everybody wants to wait 3 years, you know.
Right. I mean, and then you go, okay, well, it's a professional class. Should there be an age limit where people have to tap out? But then there's not enough room in the 450 class, right? So even if you go, all right, well, age limit now is the oldest you can be to race the lights class is 25 or 26. Well, then there's a clog in that funnel too, mm-hmm. right? But actually, Jeremy Malott from Red Bull has a pretty good idea that I think it would just take selling it to them. The idea, and that's to bring back a 250 two-stroke class that goes right in the middle. So you unclog the lights, you know, side of things, so some older guys can go in there, And then the guys that are kind of done in the 450 side, they can actually come back down and race into that too. So you're kind of unclogging two problems with one class that's cheaper to run. You know, it's cheaper to make it happen. You know, he went as far as saying, you know, I don't know if I'm supposed to say this on here, but it's a pretty good idea. I'd rather get out there and happen. But, you know, the 450 would be almost like an F1 grid. You know, each manufacturer would have a set amount of slots. You know, like, okay, KTM has three, GasGas has three, Husky has three. And you can't even race that class unless you're invited into one of those areas, because you can't go just race F1. You know, so then the guys that are off the grid, they might go back down to the 252 stroke class, and then somebody gets hurt, maybe they need them, they pop up or whatever, you know.
I really like that idea. I would almost like it to be, I love that F1 idea. I've never heard that, where each team gets
Jeremy's
so
got
many
a
slots.
Lot of good ideas.
But I'd like to see then the next step be the 250 class, TBDF, and do a 125 class as the entry level.
Right.
Because that's a great step for kids coming out of amateur. Lighter bike forces you to have good technique. Speeds are lower. Less injuries because it's a more controllable bike. I mean, you
252 strokes still get you. They're
I know, and I understand what you're saying. Yeah. The problem is these kids are moving past the 125 so quickly, you can't hardly keep them on them for 6 months.
Yeah. Well, the problem with both of those series is there's three manufacturers that don't make them and have no interest in making them again.
But think about this, though, because that's exactly the first thing I said to Jeremy when he told me. I hope he doesn't get mad at me for sharing his idea, but I don't think he would. But I said that, and I work for the one
of them that makes
one
it.
That has three different ones that it's fine with, right? But I said that. Well, yeah, but we're not taking anything away from what they already have. They still have the two classes that they've always had.
Yeah,
there's just another new one, and we've been progressive enough to stay with the development of the two stroke, you know, in the bigger bike sizes, and just because it got added in, the companies that still have them. You can race them. I mean, if it's Honda or Cowie, you know, we could just make that 252 stroke class where there's no homologation. You know, you can ride an old one if you just want to fix it up. Obviously, you know, there's some downside to that as far as competitiveness, but like, we're not saying you can't, and you're more than welcome, but we're also not taking anything away. We're not going, oh, we're taking this out so only two-stroke people can ride, you know?
See, I'd love to see that 250 class be just open displacement, just 250s, two-stroke, four-stroke, whatever you want. Because I think for a privateer guy or someone that doesn't have factory support, you put them on a 252 stroke, it's a little bit tougher to ride, right? They're a little less forgiving. But right away, you're at a level playing field horsepower-wise.
I think, and I get what you're saying, and that's not a bad idea, but when you think about it, like, so you got four-stroke sound, two-stroke sound. The crowd's going to know it's a different bike. They're not going to be going quite as fast as the 450 class, so it's acceptable. You know, it's cheaper for everybody that's involved to get a 252 stroke, get it set up, you know, get it out there and race it. You know, 250F, you got to develop it pretty good to make it as good as a 252 stroke with a pipe and silencer probably, you know. Mm-hmm. Like it's, you know, so it's one of those things that and I think the crowd would really, and I think it would generate a whole new resurgence in two-stroke life in the industry, you know?
I agree. I think there's something like that that needs to be done.
Something needs to be done, and this would have been the time to do it. I mean, I know this year is hard to pull anything off, but things are so kind of upside down right now. Now's the time to make new rules, new changes. Like, let's think outside of the box, and let's, like, if we're just kind of getting through 2021 because of the situation with COVID, for 2022 and beyond, provided we're more normal, let's make
do
some
something.
Good changes. Let's shake
noise.
It up. Let's make some cool changes to where we can create some new avenues.
Dude, I love it. If you push forward with any of that, let me know, because I'll help do whatever I can do.
He'll dust off his old two-stroke.
Yeah. I'll make you a bet. You two got to show up, though.
Yeah, no. Oh, jeez. No bets. I'm done.
I want to say, just going through all this, it seems like I don't know if you Forrest Gumped your way into good decisions or you just really, you really made good decisions. But like,
right.
I feel like you really went to the right place at the right time and really maximized every opportunity that you had, you know, like times where it would have been tough to make a call. Leaving one team, going to another,
taking the four stroke over the two stroke, but like every time it seems like you made a choice that ended up working out.
Going back to the 250 class, you know?
Yeah. Well, I appreciate that. I'm definitely not the smartest guy. I'm not a smart man.
Yeah,
stupid is a stupid does, but I think it comes. It kind of falls all the way back to, you know, my parents and upbringing, and my parents were always really good at like dissecting and like looking at a situation and kind of going, okay, let's go towards what's the positive side of this, and let's go mm-hmm. towards the positive, you know. And then surrounding myself with good people, learning mm-hmm. from people, I was always real open to learn, and then God, you know, like. I think he's kind of given me platforms and created situations and places for me to be. And there's a door that I can take he's on board with, or whatever is the correct option. And sometimes I take it, sometimes I don't. But I think the majority of the time I've been able to kind of steer that way to where, you know, things have just kind of led me in that direction. And I think things have happened for sure that have been guided by his hand, and you know, started back with my parents.
Yeah, that's
surrounding
awesome.
Surrounding yourself with good people.
That's awesome.
Good sum up.
We have a kind of a question we ask all our folks at the end is how you want to be remembered in this sport. And you kind of answered this a little bit earlier, but I'll give you another chance to just.
Yeah, you know, I mean, for sure, I always wanted to be. I knew I wasn't ever going to be remembered as the guy with the most talent. You know, they're not going to go Nathan Ramsey and Wyndham. it's just not me, right? But I think the most big heart, and maybe not the most heart. I don't even care if it's the most heart. Like just big heart, really driven, and never say die style attitude. And then the step two of that would be to have, you know, made my way around the industry without burning bridges.
Yeah, and so I would say that's spot on for both of them. I don't know. There's one person like you said when you won that race, and they both pulled up and hug you. There's no one in the pits who was. Well, except maybe the guys you beat, but nobody unhappy when you won. Yeah. They were so stoked for you. Yeah. You know what I mean?
I mean, and it that felt says that a way, lot. Which is yes. really cool. Like it's a humbling like feeling to think that people like that you did just beat are happy for you. You know what I mean? Like,
well, yeah, and sometimes our biggest moments are from our peers when they're proud of us. Yeah. You know, from what we do, because those are the guys you're racing, the guys you know ultimately you get respect from them, and it's real huge.
Yeah,
yeah. Your career was kind of low key, but man, it was. You look back, and it's impressive. Like, when I was going through and putting this together, I'm like, dang.
Yeah, thank
Nate
you.
Nate Dogg got a, he you. Got it done.
Yeah.
It's impressive, dude.
I think it's, yeah, thank you. I just, yeah, again, it just sort of worked out, you know?
Yeah.
Not a rocket science, and I definitely appreciate being here, and then obviously Budman coming, and he's been a huge, huge part of a lot of the decisions and you know, a lot of the progress along the way. So, you know, from day one, he's always – took me under his wing
from the moment he came out and skimmed those coffin woofs.
It goes back to what you're saying. You see, you work with somebody that just has the heart and has the mindset to want to learn and get better. And that was Nate Dogg from day one until he was done racing. Yeah. And he's always been that guy. And that's probably why he made good decisions and he always performed the best he could.
Yeah, that's awesome. Hey, I want to thank you for being here too.
Thank you.
How can people find you if they want to do some training?
Well, you know, Basically, I've never really advertised, but lately I've been advertising a few camps on social media. So it's Budman Antunez, and follow me and see if I post anything up. Might be coming to a town near you soon.
Yeah, and those camps are great because they're usually a little more affordable than like one-on-one training, but you get all the same info, right?
It is, and my goal with these is obviously I've been, you know, working the tracks around here in California for a while, and so I want to get a little bit more outreach, mm-hmm. you know, and pass the things along that me and Nathan have designed together and we've worked on to craft and make good to make riders better, safer, all those things. So if I can start hitting a few different stops and reaching some other kids and adults for that, or adults for that matter, I would be super happy, you know, and it would fulfill me in a way, because there's something you get keyed up on at the end of the day when you watch somebody learn go from here to here at the end of the day. It's very rewarding and a lot of fun.
Yeah, it is for sure. Well, thank both of you guys for coming on. I'm like just so stoked to call you both friends.
Yeah, hey, buddy.
Thanks, man. I
love seeing you. I know our paths don't cross as much as
I know.
I know.
Life is just that way lately.
Yeah, it's crazy how that happens.
It doesn't change when you get back around each other, though. Yeah. You know what I mean? So
I think the BS started 2 minutes after we got here.
I think he did.
Yeah.
Maybe less than that.
Yeah. Yeah. 30 seconds.
All right. Well, thanks so much, Bud. We're going to get you back on to have your show.
Yeah, absolutely.
But, Nate, thanks so much for coming in and making the time.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, people are going to dig it. Thank you guys for watching. We'll be back to wrap up the show. Stay tuned. I want to be bad with you, girl, like we're robbing a bank. I want to be mad at the world, like it took you away. Don't want to be mad. All right, welcome back, everybody. That was a Nathan Ramsey, Buddy Antunez. What a couple of great guys. I hope you guys enjoyed that. I'm so bummed I don't get to hang out with them more. Great guys. So stoked to go through Nate's story. You know, I hope that his... who he is kind of came through, because he's just such an honest, genuine, great guy, you know? So, and an amazing career, truly. I think he was very underrated. And, anyway, stoked he's still in the sport. It's good for us that he's still here. We're going to jump into our SKDA Q&A. If you guys are in the market for graphics, please go check them out. I can't even tell you how outside the box these guys are. They've got clean, they've got crazy, they've got 90s retro, whatever you want. They really do an awesome job, and the shipping is incredible. The communication is incredible. When it ships, you get an email. When it lands in the States, you get an email, and then the day they're delivering, you get one. I mean, they just really do everything right, and the quality's top-notch. Go check out the SKDA guys. Awesome, awesome people over there. Questions. Mike, what do we have?
We got a couple good ones this time, Dave. And I always want to add, too, that I had to cover my mic. I was laughing so hard doing this show. This was a really enjoyable show.
Yeah, it was fun.
All right, our first question is from David DeKing, 1972. And his question is, why is traditional motocross in the U.S. being marginalized in favor of supercross? Is there a way of getting the pendulum to swing back just a little?
I think the bottom line is money. You know, there's so much more money in supercross. The corporations are looking at it. The teams are looking at it. There's more exposure. There's more casual fans, where the folks showing up to a motocross race, putting up with the heat and the dust and the longer motos, they're core fans, right? They're not going anywhere. And so I think that they feel like they can get to a broader audience with supercross. And so there's just more money in it, is the bottom line. And I think it's a shame, because, you know, like you've even said, you prefer motocross all day long
all
over
day
supercross.
Long.
But the almighty dollar speaks, you know what I mean? And that it runs the world. So I think that it's – the bummer to me is that we don't have a balance. I would just like to see it balanced again, because as soon as supercross really started carrying more weight, you can see it on a global stage where – at the Motocross de Nations, we started losing. And we're now, I don't want to say we're not even close, but, I mean, we are definitely not the favorites going into that race anymore.
Right.
So I don't know that it'll ever come back. Like I said, I mean, if I see it dividing more, where you'll eventually have two separate sports. And it would be like, just like right now, there's a group that races GNCC and one that races Works Racing, and there's Hare and Hound, and there's Enduro. There'll be Supercross, and there'll be Motocross, and it'll be different people that race those two different events. You know, I think we're one of the last ones who still do both. Look at even Dakar. Those guys do just rally. They might have four or five events a year. That's it.
So do you see at some point that you're just going to see guys who are factory Supercross riders, and if there is a factory Motocross team, those guys just do factory motocross?
I think that's a possibility. If I was a team manager, I'd look at that. You know, because it's like what we talked about on the show today. People have an affinity for one or the other typically. There's some guys who are equally good in both, but it's very rare. So if you've got a guy, like let's say Justin Brayton, I'd sign him up all day long to ride supercross for me. And he got a podium this year, right? But maybe there's an outdoor guy that could ride his bike for the summer. So the team still goes all year. But you pick your supercross guys and you pick your outdoor guys. And maybe there's a guy who's good in both and you run him all year. But it wouldn't shock me to start seeing some specializing and having the teams focus on that. It's going to be less money in salary. But as supercross continues to increase in value, you know, they're going to make more money for purse money and things like that. And I don't know. We'll see what happens. It's kind of I don't see motocross ever making this huge push back to where it's as important as supercross. It's just there's not the money in it.
That's sad. Okay, we have one more question, and that is from, hang on here, Motomaniac54. Do the people that have been in the sport for a long time, e.g. Mitch, Roger, Chad, Ricky, manufacturers and other people on the business side of the sport, ever sit around the table, put egos aside, and discuss what's next for the sport? Where are we heading? What is plan B should energy drinks pull out? This is the end of the, each season seems to make sense. Not a dick stretching contest, just open, honest feedback.
To my knowledge, no, they don't. And I think that that's a shame. I think that it would be great to once a year, maybe it's after the last national of the year, you get have the guys from Feld come out, you get the MX Sports guys together, you get every team manager in the room, some of the top riders in there, whoever wants to show up, you know, marquee riders, and you just have a round table. Like, hey, what went well this year? What went poorly? What can we improve? How can we make things better for the riders? How can we make it more friendly for race teams? How can we make it to where, you know, the promoters have an easier time of it? And maybe, you know, some years, maybe there's some things you don't make any progress on, but man, at least everybody can lay their shit out on the table and say, here's where we're at. Here's what we'd like to see. And that way, at least everyone's talking. You know, right now I feel like everybody after the races goes back to their truck and they piss and moan and whine, but it's like nobody ever gets together and goes, how can we solve this collectively? Let's put our heads together and try to come up with some solutions to the lapper problem, to the, you know, schedule problem, to whatever. To my knowledge, those kind of meetings don't happen, and it's too bad.
Well, I think it goes back to what you were talking about, what Nathan had brought up about the 250 feeder class. And I kind of thought, too, my first thought was, well, why not make it a 125 class as the stepping stone to the 250s as opposed to having the intermediate between the 250 and the 450s. But, I mean, you know, they said, well, okay, only Yamaha and so a couple of the Italian manufacturers and the Austrian guys make two-strokes. Well, this would actually, I mean, look, what did Yamaha have to do to update the 250? Not a lot. They've already got a really good four-stroke 250. I can't imagine it would be much of a stretch to take that two-stroke motor and adapt that that chassis already for that. So you've got, you know, and put an electric start on it, boom. Yamaha would probably own that market anyways.
Yeah.
You know? So I just, it would, those are the kind of things that A, I think people would love to see two strokes out there again. They love the sound, they love the smell. And like you said, it's such a, it's a much cheaper way for privateers to continue racing.
And the reason that I love his idea, I thought it was fantastic. The reason I would try to push for like a level 250 class. So if you want to race a 250 two stroke, go ahead. You know, we're always pushing for, The production rule was to keep the playing field more level for the privateers and the people who don't have all the money. Well, that there you go. That's your answer. You know, you could put maybe limits on whatever you wanted to put limits on to keep that 250 two-stroke from being too fast if you're worried about that. But really, I could get the fastest 250 made. It's not going to be an advantage over Mitch's bikes, over the Star Yamaha bikes. It's just not. It's just going to get me to where at least I can get a start against them now. At least I can get over the jumps, right? Because if you're Johnny Jackass and you're just going to your local guy, like, you know, like Nate's first bike, where you say it was a pile of crap, it's like you don't even stand a chance. You're not even on the same in the same stratosphere as those factory four strokes, right? And to try to buy that, one, you can't buy some of the things they have. Two, it would cost you thousands and thousands of dollars. You can get a 252 stroke running well, cheap. But I like the 125 concept as that feeder class because the 125 is the perfect entry-level bike for people wanting to dab their toe in the motocross waters. It's the most inexpensive bike. It's the easiest to ride. It's the safest to ride because it's light. You know, it's easy to handle. I'm for things that ultimately will grow the sport. And I know the concern is always, well, look at what Honda did in road racing. They got pissy about the rules, so they took their ball and they went home. They pulled out of it completely. And that sport's never recovered here in the States. They're afraid of that happening here, and I get it. But again, if we could sit down and have these, you know, open discussions with all the representative from each manufacturer and say, here's some ideas. What do you guys think of this? What if we did this? It's not going to affect your – we're still going to run 250Fs and 450s, but we're going to allow some of these other players to come in or this class here. We'd love it if you guys would participate, but if you don't, it's fine. How do you feel about that? You know, rather than being afraid to make a rule change or try something new because you don't know what they might do, I just wish we could all be adults and sit down and, you know, hash it out. I'd love that. Maybe we can organize that here from the show. We'll see.
I like it. Good show today, Dave. Really good.
Thank you. So, yeah, thanks to Nathan and Budman. Thank you to SKDA. Thanks, everyone, sending in your questions. We've still got quite a good list, but if you have anything you want, man, shoot us a question on our Instagram or on our Twitter. We're trying to just use Twitter specifically for that, but send it to us. We'll answer it, any kind of questions. I also want to mention one of our newest partners that's come on, that's Stasic, Stability Cycle is what that is short for. They've come on as a partner. We're going to help them promote a couple of events, and that'll be forthcoming. We got news. Hopefully by the next show, we got some really cool news on some live shows that we're going to be doing. It's been difficult. We can't do them here at TLD just because of the rules with businesses here in California still are ridiculous. So we found a location. We are sorting out dates. It's going to be a lot of fun. Some really neat stuff, including a race for little kids on these. But, you know, we talk about 125 being the stepping stone into adults and teenagers that want to try our sport. What this little bike is doing, getting kids excited about motorcycles, I don't think the effects of it can be overstated. It is so big. Getting little kids dialed in and excited about riding at this age, because those are kids that will continue to ride the rest of their lives. So before the PW, Yamaha PW is kind of the gold standard, but this gets them going even sooner in an even safer fashion at a cheaper price. I mean, it's just an amazing product. If you've got little kids, man, check these out, because it's an incredible tool for teaching them balance. Even if you have no intention of racing, but just what a fun tool to get your kid out doing something fun, right? So check them out. And again, we'll be announcing some new events we've got coming up very soon. Excited about those. And I just want to thank all of our partners again. Yamaha, amazing products top to bottom. If you're a motocross guy, this 450 and 250F are top of the heap. These two bikes are amazing. They still make two strokes. They make stand up watercraft, sit down jet skis, side by sides, you name it. Generators, all kinds of amazing products that we use in this industry. So please go to Yamaha and support them for supporting us. PowerDot, if you guys are looking for one of these devices, 20% off using our code WhiskeyThrottle. No spaces, no capitals. You will not be disappointed if you use this thing. From sore muscles to tight spots in between your shoulder blades, your neck, if you bruise something, hurt something, strain something, if you have to get a surgery, this is the ultimate recovery tool. And there's just nothing that works better. It's an amazing product. Method Race Wheels. We did pick a winner. Can't remember his name, but out of Lake Elsinore, we contacted him this week. Our Method Race Wheels contest we were doing on social media. If you don't follow us on Instagram, we're giving stuff away left and right. So Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, TikTok, we have accounts on all those. Check us out. Find us. But if you did not win the wheels, 20% off using our code on a full set of wheels. Definitely take advantage of that. Troy Lee Designs, big thank you to those guys. Check their gear out. Stuff is awesome looking. I mean, you can see the stuff Barsh is wearing and the 250 guys, Moseman. Very, very clean, very cool looking stuff. Dunlop Tires. MX-53, MX-33 combo. 53 front, 33 rear. Try it. I tell everybody, I get a lot of questions. Hey, what's that combo you like? Those are the two best tires in our sport right now, in my opinion. For the widest range, too. So from hard pack to very soft, that works great. The MX-12 rear, if you get into really soft, probably then you want to go 33 front with a 12 rear. That's basically a paddle tire. Thing is gnarly, but it works great in sand and soft. Big thank you to Nihilo Concepts. These guys are making some incredible products. If you guys are not familiar with them, the latest one we just put on one of our Vital MX builds is the secondary on switch. Just a simple wire that attaches to your battery connection, and you mount a little button underneath, up underneath your frame or airbox, somewhere that it's hidden and protected, so that if you go down and your start button doesn't work, short of bump starting it, how are you going to start your bike? So this is a secondary on switch that just lets you start your bike if that main switch gets damaged or broken. It's one of those things like, man, why didn't we think of that? That's a great idea. But they make frame tape, lever grip, they make all kinds of billet products, carbon fiber now. They're doing some amazing carbon fiber stuff. Check them out. Seat Concepts, if you're in the market for a seat, these are your guys. from custom stuff to covers to molds, whatever you want. They make it for just about anything you want. Senna headsets. Listen, this Bluetooth technology is incredible for coaching. If you have a kid that rides this, you need this. I'm telling you, you can spot them on the track. You can coach them if they're doing something wrong. You can help them with line selection. If somebody's down on the backside of a jump, it could be the difference between them getting hurt badly and them being able to avoid it. I can't stress enough how cool of a product that is on a lot of different levels. Pro-X, excited to have these guys on board. We just did a bunch of a project bike with their chain, and they make sprockets, air filters, all kinds of cables, gaskets. They make a lot of products, and they're super, super high quality. They kind of bridge that gap between really high quality products and affordability. A lot of their manufacturers are, some of them are in Japan, but this isn't cheap Chinese made crap. It's very, very high quality OEM standard quality at a more affordable price. So stoked to have them on board. Also Motul Lubricants, excited to have these guys join us as well. Very, very established, well-respected brand in auto racing and motorcycle racing around the world. They won the Dakar last year with Ricky Brabec. Amazing products. Really, really excited. I just got a bunch of it to start playing with and trying. And I've used them in the past, but all their new stuff. I'm excited to have them on board. Great company. OGO Power Sports. If you're in the market for a bag, hydration pack, boot bag, helmet bag, roller bag for traveling, there is not a better roller bag for traveling. These things are amazing and incredibly durable. Check them out. Specialized Bicycles, if you're in the market, this is the bike to get, period. They've got some really cool new stuff coming out. I can't really say anything about the new bike they have coming, but it's coming soon. So stand by. We'll give you a bunch of info there. But if you're in the market for anything, e-bike, downhill, cross-country, anything in between, they're your guys. So get over to Specialized and check out all their products. And Pro Circuit, thank you guys. Thank you guys so much for tuning in. We appreciate it. Got some great shows coming next week. Dave Castillo and Andy Harrington. It's going to be a lot of fun. We're going to go over their racing careers and then dive into their careers in the stunt world in Hollywood now. They're both doing great and killing it. So excited for that show as well. So until then, thank you. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.
Thanks for watching the Whiskey Throttle Show. Don't forget to like and subscribe and click the bell to get alerts for all the latest content. Follow us on Twitter at @W_Throttle_Show and on TikTok, Facebook, and Instagram @Whiskey Throttle Show. Oh, yeah.